This week on the Bloody Bits Horror Show, we let our imaginations run away with us as we discuss the 1962 horror classic, Carnival of Souls. Hello and welcome to the Bloody Bits Horror Show. I am your host, Eddie, the Axe Jefferson, and joining me as always, my right-hand man, Tim Yobo. How are you doing today, sir?
I'm good. I'm glad to be here, Eddie. I had a good time with this movie. I'm looking forward to talking about it.
Yeah, I had a good time with it, too. This is, of course, our last week of Patreon picks, I guess, and
smooth.
What an interesting selection too, man.
Who picked it?
So this comes from Patreon Steve. He gave us two options. He said either Carnival of Souls or Eyes Without a Face.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, because you asked me, I was like, you know what? Let's take a break from having. I don't want to have to keep reading subtitles and take notes because it takes like four times as long.
That's very true. And this one definitely moves at a clip, man. Let me tell you.
And it's the first time I ever saw it.
Yeah, same here, actually, is kind of, I guess, iconic as this is. I never actually got around to watching it because it's, man, I mean, just the amount of people that it has influenced and where it takes its influences from.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting stuff. Plus, you know, I'd want to do the Billy Idol song if we did Eyes Without a Face.
Oh, so. Boy. Well, you can't put the show on YouTube if you do that song. So.
Oh, my God. Yeah, fucking YouTube. Every time I upload something, I get some...
What if it's you singing the song, though? Like a cappella? Is that still considered a no-no?
Well, so what's funny about that, actually, is, first of all, it wasn't YouTube. It was on Twitch. But the lead guitarist of Dragon Force got DMCA'd for playing his own music.
Hmm. I heard Metallica had a problem with on Twitch this weekend,
too.
And good for them. That's karma.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, they got hired to perform at BlizzCon, and that was being live-streamed via Twitch, you know, because with the COVID, you can't really have conventions right now.
Nope.
So Twitch dropped the feed on Metallica.
No, they showed the feed. They just played some, like, elevator music over it.
Oh, they did?
That's what made it even better. Because you see Lars there banging out on the fucking drum, just counting all that money from the residual checks he's going to get.
Yeah.
From somebody downloading from Napster. And all of a sudden, it's just elevator music turns on.
Oh, that's wonderful. Fuck those guys, man. They haven't made a good album since Master of Puppets.
Well, actually, because I was just talking to somebody about Metallica, a friend of mine, mm-hmm. and I think he does make a point. I mean, they pretty much are like the number one metal band.
Was there
anybody really bigger than them, whether you like them or not, which I think there's like maybe two songs, and it's probably like their most commercial songs that I kind of like, but they've been around for a long time, they made a lot of albums, and they're probably the biggest, longest-lasting metal band around.
Yeah, absolutely. As far as like crossover appeal becoming like a pop culture kind of thing, then I think they're probably the biggest. Gosh, I mean, you've got like Judas Priest. They never
made it as big as Metallica.
Yeah, Maiden, kind of.
Still, no, same thing. It's really Metallica's the one that sold out those fucking gigantic stadiums and has been around and consistently around forever, basically.
I mean, you could make a case for Rob Zombie, but I think that also was kind of off the back of his film career, too.
Yeah, and has he been around as long as Metallica?
No. I mean, White Zombie
Zombie's been around for a while, but I don't think White Zombie goes back to Metallica, Megadeth, Wasp, all those.
Wasp. No, not back to Wasp.
When you grew up, Eddie, what did Wasp stand for? Because I think there's a couple of different versions of the acronym.
Yeah, so it was We Are Satan's People.
See, the ones I heard was we are sexual perverts.
We're sexual perverts. Well, from the Animal Fuck Like a Beast album cover,
That's where it came from, yeah. My friend
that makes
Vinko
sense.
told me that.
Vinka, what the fuck is this? That can't be the guy's name.
That was his name, yeah.
Oh
He
my
was
God.
Yugoslavian. Well, I don't know if
Okay.
I can say Yugoslavian anymore. Maybe a Croatian? Oh, wait, if
Yeah.
he's Serbian. Oh, fuck, I better not answer my door for the next couple of weeks. I say Croatia, but
Uh-oh.
yeah, Vinko
Yeah.
was his name-o.
Huh. That's a hell of a name, man. Hell of a name.
You gotta have game if your name is Vinko.
You really do, man, because you're overcoming some obstacles out the gate. So, Carnival of Souls, coming over some obstacles, man. This little bit of background on it. It was shot on a $33,000 budget, filmed in Lawrence, Kansas, and of course Salt Lake City. And you might have noticed that it employed some very grindhouse-style filmmaking. A lot of locations they didn't really have permission to film in, let's say.
It's
So,
1962. Where did they film it?
it was filmed in two locations. Initially, it was filmed in what was Lawrence, Kansas, and Salt Lake City, Utah.
Well, I mean, you could probably get away with it a lot easier doing guerrilla filmmaking there than you could, like, New York
Yeah.
or California, right?
Yeah, no, that's definitely true. I mean, especially Lawrence, Kansas. Like, that's kind of where it begins at with the them having the nice drag race over the river.
Is this a drag race, though? I have written down. The movie starts off with, hey,
Yeah.
let's drag, but they're turning. It's like, I mean, obviously, the people who are drag racing in these two cars, they've lived in this town. They know where they're, like, the end of the race is supposed to be because they're
Yeah.
twisting and turning all over the place.
This is more like a rally car race
There you go.
that we get. So it was produced and directed by Herc Hervey and written by John Clifford. The story was inspired by the hitchhiker episode of The Twilight Zone, which you can kind of see a little bit of that in there.
I mean, it's a common enough theme, right? So, yeah, but Twilight Zone is probably the first place I saw it.
Yeah, and the writer says he kind of saw that building, the location, the abandoned pavilion out on the Great Salt Lake, and it inspired him to to write this. So they had a location in mind before they had a story, which interesting way of doing things, but it kind of
This
works.
didn't Romero kind of do kind of well, not really, maybe 100%, but he saw that shopping mall and that gave him the idea for Dawn of the Dead, right?
Yeah, so actually, Romero credits this for the inspiration of for Night of the Living Dead, this film Carnival of Souls, as well as David Lynch has said that this has been kind of a one of the influential films for him, getting started with like Eraserhead
I
and
could see that, yeah.
yeah, could absolutely. So it stars Candace Hilgoss as Mary Henry, and well, it's Candace not with an I, so I guess it's a little bit better.
The smart way of spelling it.
That's right, the smart way of spelling it. And I mean, I have to say that this movie kind of lives and dies on her performance because,
Oh, yeah.
man, we're with her beginning to end. What's funny is her agent actually dropped her after he saw this movie, too.
Really? Because I was like, she did a pretty good job. I mean, she kind of does like a Marilyn Chambers from Rabbit, right? Where
Oh,
it's like you said, it
yeah.
lives or dies on what she's doing in the movie, and she carries it off.
Yeah. I mean, she, as far as I'm concerned, she's probably the biggest part of this movie. I mean, certainly acting wise, but as far as like her reaction to the world around her, sets the tone for the fear and the horror elements of it.
Well, I'll assume you'll tell us if she's done other stuff before or since.
Yeah, so she has done a few things after this. Let me pull up the list here real quick. Because she had a little bit of a career. She was in The Curse of the Living Corpse as Deborah Benson. South of Hell Mountain. I don't know what the
Oh, man,
fuck
that's
that
a
is.
bad part of the mountain.
Yeah.
You don't want to get caught in the south of the mountain.
No, not at all. And Quincy M.E., she was in an episode of that.
Wow. All right. So Sir Charles, I know, I guarantee you Sir Charles watched Quincy because Quincy liked to get down and get funky with the ladies when he wasn't carving up corpses and seeing what was going on. But Sir Charles would get that reference.
Yeah, that's about it, though. But there is a video short called A Schoolgirl's Diary that came out in 2019 that apparently she has some sort of an appearance in, but that's
Okay.
not a ton that she went on to.
Probably playing somebody's grandma, right?
Yeah, maybe. Or maybe it's just like archival footage. So another just fun fact about this movie before we get into the breakdown, though, Tim, is when they made the movie, they failed to put the little copyright stamp on
Oh
this.
no. And wow, and fucking George Romero does the same thing with Night of the Living Dead.
Yep. So the day this thing came out, it was public domain.
Wow.
Yeah. So
Shit.
I guess maybe that also was kind of inspired Romero.
Yeah. He
Accidentally.
watched the movie all the way through. He took his notes and he's like, all right, it's the movie starts like this and this is exactly how it ends. It doesn't have any kind of a code protection on it. I don't need it.
Yeah, who needs that shit? Well, like you said, Tim, we start with three gals. They're in their old car. And then there's some blokes, and they're in their old car, and they pull up to each other and ask if they want to drag. And Tim, this must bring you back to
No, not old enough to remember drag racing.
your
I'm
days
old
at
enough. I
the
remember seeing movies about it, so I know what it is. And I don't know if I, like we said, we call this drag racing, but
No.
it's racing.
Yeah. So they're racing all around town. They swerve over onto the bridge from Stand By Me, and well, the accident that they get into doesn't look great. She just kind of like jerks the wheel real quick.
Well, he does. He kind of like bumps her a little bit before that.
Oh, okay.
That's not, that's, I don't think that's, I don't know if that's what causes the accident because it looks like he bumps her and it looks like they're driving for a little bit while longer before she looks like she just takes the car and just turns it right off the bridge and goes head first into the water.
Yeah, bust through the railing, which appears to be a couple of 2x4s, and
Well, yeah, you saw that
directly into the
bridge.
drink.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Must have cost, I mean, out of that $33,000 budget, I bet that was like, 10, $15 to fix the bridge.
That and the car, right?
Yeah, well, the car, that's a good point, man, because they fucking sunk a car down into that lake. It's, man,
I mean, I know they built them tough back then, but still, I don't know if you can get that out of the lake and refurbish it.
No, it's got some water damage, man. That wood paneling, that's gonna swell. They're gonna need to refinish it.
Man, the fucking Carfax on that, Jesus, that piece of shit.
Jeez. It's a good thing they didn't have Carfax back then, man. So then we the guys stop and they just kind of look over the rail like, ah, shit. And then we get our title card for Carnival of Souls in the murky waters below.
Comes up all nice and wavy.
Yeah. And I kind of miss those old-fashioned like title cards like that with the fun little visual effects. And they do some other weird visual effects
Yeah.
a little later on, which is kind of neat for back then.
Yeah, I was rubbing my eyes. I thought there was something wrong.
Yeah, well, there could have been too. We'll get to that part, and we'll make sure it's not just that you have like a cataract going on or something too. Because now we cut to the cops, and they're out there dredging the lake, which is like just hucking a big hook into it.
Yeah, I haven't written down the way that they're doing it is they're never going to find anything unless it's like what, 20 feet away from that one spot where they're just
Yeah,
throwing the hook in and trying to grab something.
they keep tossing it in the same spot. Like, did they see the car and they just keep missing it? Like, what's going on?
I mean, maybe they can figure out from where the bridge was broken in the general area, but I mean, the bridge
Yeah.
looked like it looked like they were towards the middle of the bridge when they went into the water, right?
Yeah, and they were like over by the shore when they were dredging it, which I
Yeah.
mean, I guess you kind of gotta be, but
Oh
what are
well,
we gonna
lazy
do?
police work.
Yeah. So one of the dudes tells the cop, he says, "Look, man, we've been out here for like 3 hours trying to do this, so I don't want to say anything, but they're probably fucking dead by now." Like,
Yeah, it's just turned into a recovery.
Yeah. At this
So we
point,
can
they just
go
want the
home and come
scrap.
back tomorrow when it's not freezing cold.
Yeah, exactly. And I also have a note that one of the dudes in the car like lies, and he's like, "Ah, we weren't racing. We were."
Yeah, no, he says that they tried to get around us, and the cop says, "Are you sure you didn't like bump them or something like that?" And he's like,
Yeah.
"No, sir."
No, of course not. And it's not like there's any witnesses, so you kind of
Yeah,
got to
because
go
it's
back.
been 3 hours, right? I just heard the cop say it's 3 hours.
Yeah. So I don't think this is going to be coming up later, but uh-oh, it is coming up later because old Blondie comes stumbling out of the water.
And actually, it's a really kind of creepy good scene, too, the way that
Yeah.
she's walking on that thing. But I noticed her hair wasn't wet.
Yeah, that was a little weird. I mean, that could have been that old hairspray they used to use back then in that Aquanet.
Aquanet? There you go.
Yeah. Yeah, just the water just beads right off of
There you
it now.
go. That's right.
So she kind of, yeah, comes up out of the water. People are like, "Jesus Christ, the fuck happened?" She's like, I don't really remember, man. I gotta go."
Yeah,
She's
this
kind
kind
of.
of would be a big story, right? 1962, even if you're in some hick town and wherever this is supposed to really be taking place. She was supposedly underwater for 3 hours.
Yeah. No, especially if this is in some hick town. There's nothing for them to talk
Oh,
about.
exactly. Yeah, exactly right. I forget. The general store is closed down. Main Street is a
Yeah.
ghost town because everybody is there because something new happened. And then
Yeah.
here, yeah, because actually you do see a bunch of people run across the bridge.
Oh, yeah.
And they're
Yeah,
all
there's a
gathered
bunch of.
around her and everything like that. And they're like, "What happened to the rest of your friends?" She's like, "I don't know." No, that's
Yeah.
it. Nobody's asking any questions.
Yeah, I mean, those three women going missing in this town, I mean, that's going to eliminate at least like 70% of the genetic diversity. You know?
It might
Like,
actually help to
well,
clean it up.
shit. We're going to.
Because you have to get three new women to replace them,
That's true, yeah.
right?
We're going to need to go to another, the next town over to fucking bramble shoot or whatever. So, yeah, she just kind of comes out, says she lost her memory of what happened here, and well, I guess she comes back the next day to look around. She's watching him dredging through the water some more, and then we cut to her playing with her organ.
And it's a magic organ, right? Because the whole time, whenever she's playing and touching her organ, everybody just stops what they're doing and it's like mesmerized, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, I know I was at attention, Tim. Did you get a
Reminds
look
me
at
of
the.
that old question of, would you rather have four roses on your piano or tulips on your organ?
Hey-o. So, man, and the set of pipes on this organ, too. My lord.
Well, I'll tell you, this movie taught me a lot about organ playing, which I
Yeah?
some of this stuff I did not know.
Okay. We'll get to that then. So the music that she's playing here, not bad, by the way. This whole film has a pretty great soundtrack, actually.
It really does, yeah. I bet you Bobby
Yeah.
has it on soundtrack, right?
I'm sure Bobby does. And what's an interesting touch is that she, because she plays the organ, sometimes you're not really sure if the music that she's listening or the music that's in the film is diegetic or not. Like, is this something she's hallucinating or is this just atmospheric? You know what I mean? Because a
Yeah,
lot of
because it's
it
also a part
is.
where she's driving later on. She's turning her radio and she's turning the dial.
Yes,
And as it's
yes.
turning, you're hearing the same music no matter what she's turning it to.
Yeah. So I just, the note I have here is it reminded me of there was this place in Portland, Oregon. It was called the Organ Grinder, right? And it was this big ass, like two-story family pizza place. And they had a massive pipe organ right in the front of it. And they would
Wow.
have this screen come down where they would show old silent cartoons. And they had a pipe organist that would play music over the silent cartoons.
Now
And they
that's a
turned these.
fucking draw.
Yeah. No, this place was the shit, dude. And they had like a bubble machine they'd turn on when that shit was going on. Dude, it was fucking awesome. And you got some decent pizza, so you know.
You're in Portland, so the best you could hope for is decent pizza.
Yeah, not a lot of good pizza up there. I mean, we did have Sparrow's in the Mall 205. So
Yeah, Was it the family owned Sparrow in the
No,
same
no.
generation?
No. This was after they franchised it out
Oh
to the
man,
malls. It
whenever I
was.
walk past the Sparrows in New York, well, not anymore, but hopefully soon.
Yeah.
But back in the day, and I would see people going, and I was just like, oh man, you know, it's no,
What are
it's
you
like the
doing?
biggest thing that you're a fucking tourist, that you're nobody who lives in New York goes in that fucking
No.
place to eat unless you've been constipated for 2 months
Yeah.
and you want to get it out real fucking quick.
Well, yeah, because you could throw a stone and hit three or four original Joe's or Joe's Originals or places where you can get a decent
Oh.
slice for like $1, $1.50.
Yeah. No, there's another restaurant I'm trying to. Oh, Original Ray's.
Ray's, yeah,
That's
that's
the
the
thing.
one.
Because I used to work down the village and I thought that was the Original Ray's.
Yeah.
I think it's on like 8th Street and like between 1st and A or someplace around that. But,
Yeah.
and then I got started working uptown. I was like, there's another Ray. And I was like, they're the original. What the fuck?
So there's original Ray's and Ray's original.
And then there's how they different, they're spelling it differently.
Yeah. Oh man. So I missed that place. It was a pretty decent joint. And yeah, like you said, man, she gets the attention of everybody. Like every head is turned over at her when she's playing with her organ. And I gotta wonder, because it turns out she's heading to Utah to play organ at church, right? And her friend, whoever this guy is, they don't really get into his character. He's just kind of like, so you're gonna go play at the church, huh? What's up with that?
Oh, you mean the old man?
Yeah,
Yeah.
yeah. And then she tells him, look, I don't really care about the church or anything.
She says, I'm not taking any vows, I'm just
Yeah.
playing the organ. Which I
Right.
think is a good line, and especially something back then, because she's kind of
Yeah.
like dissing the church.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, because he's kind of taken aback by it when she says this. And he's like, well, how about on the way? Are you going to visit your folks? And she's like, no, I'm in a hurry. I got to get there, you know? And he's like, all right, well, maybe next time when you come back, you could, like, talk to me or whatever. And she's like, I'm never coming back. Fuck this. And I'm just like, did she just like rob a bank or something? Is this like the beginning of Psycho? What's going on here?
Well, what's going on is I think she's getting away from the trauma that was getting
Yeah.
into a fucking car accident and two of her friends are dead.
That's true.
And you're in a small town, so like you said before, everybody knows everybody's business. That's
Yeah.
gonna take like 10 times as long to fucking
Oh,
like
God.
kind of like fade into the background, right?
Yeah,
'Cause
that's
in a
like when
small
you.
town, how long before somebody burns her for being a witch because she's the one who survived it and stayed on the water for 3 fucking hours? She's got to get out.
That's very true, man. She did live without oxygen for 3 hours, so yeah, she might be a witch.
And her hair came out perfect.
Yeah. No shit, man. But like, oh God, and then you just imagine like when somebody breaks their arm, how many times they have to explain the story of
Yep,
when they
yep, yep,
broke
yep,
their
yep,
fucking
yep.
arm. Well, hey, there's Mary with the dead two friends. Hey, Mary, why don't you tell us again about what happened? Like,
Plus, she's also
yeah.
got to get out because those two guys, the jig is up for them because she's going to be able to tell the cops that they were drag racing.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I mean, I don't think she wants to drop the dime, though, because,
That's, well, you know
that.
what? Yeah, that's right. She doesn't snitch. She just
No,
gets out of
no.
town.
Yeah. I mean, and to be fair, like, she was just a passenger. She couldn't really do shit.
Yeah, I have written down earlier in the notes, we skipped over it. The two other women in the car,
Yeah.
they're like, they're perfectly innocent fucking victims, right? Because they're
Yeah.
not agreeing to this drag race. They both have a look on their face like, oh shit, what the
Oh,
fuck?
yeah. Yeah, no, and the driver lady, like, she's into it. She's smoking a cigarette, so you know she's a bad girl,
Yeah, she's
you
got one
know?
hand out the window smoking a cigarette and the other hand driving in a fucking drag race.
Yep. So, like you said, Tim, she packs up her crap. She loads up into the car. She goes driving off into the night. And this is where I have the note about the music, because as you said, she initially tunes in. There's some kind of like upbeat, decent sounding music. But then as day turns to night, much like in Castlevania 2, Simon's Quest, the curse comes out. And the music,
deep cut.
Yeah, the music starts to sound all discordant and creepy. And she's like flipping through the different channels that you do, the different stations.
But the music stays the same, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah, all right.
So, you know something's going on. She's driving into Silent Hill, ladies and gentlemen. And, well, how do you know you're almost in Silent Hill? Well, when you look at your window and you see Scott Aukerman from Comedy Bang Bang. this dude that's fucking in the window. Like, oh my God. I know that they used a bunch of, like, just extras for this that they paid, you know, peanuts, I'm sure.
$33,000.
Yeah, not a lot of budget going on here. So she sees this dude. She freaks the fuck out. Looks out the front of the window and, oh shit, some gray-haired old guy pops up in the middle of the road, like fucking in the mouth of madness.
Well, yeah, because she sees this other guy in, like, the reflection of the window, the passenger window.
Yeah.
And the way they did the effect is actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Because he fades out, and then it fades to her, and then she looks down the road, and she sees, I have written down, just this crazy-ass-looking dude.
Yeah, some crazy-looking old gray-haired guy. She slams on the brakes, veers off the road, you know, because she doesn't want to hit the guy.
Crash. Two times in 3 days, she's crashed. You think maybe she wants to, like, take a bus?
Well, yeah, she tries that later, and doesn't work out.
Doesn't work out too well. All right, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, now veers off the road, but, hey, it's no big deal. She's, you know, kind of backs back up onto the road and drives off to go gas up.
All right, I have a question. I don't have a car. Why did the engine turn off?
Why
after
did
she, like, ran out the road? Because she had to turn the engine back on.
Yeah. You know what? I have no idea. That doesn't make any sense.
Okay. Just a dumb question.
No. It's, maybe it was something with the fucking cars from back in fucking 19-dickety-2 or whenever the fuck that car came from. She had to get out and get that big metal key that they shove in the hood and turn the crank, you know?
She had to crank it up, yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, I think you need two people for that. I think you need somebody to crank the car and then somebody to, like, gas it up, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus. We've come so far, man.
All right, now let me ask you a question, because I started watching this on YouTube, right? And I stopped watching on YouTube because, number one, the subtitles weren't coming up, and I always like watching it with subtitles.
Same.
And the sound was, like, really fucking horrible. Hard to listen to. I had to put my headphones on and turning it up. But on the YouTube cut, at this point, the subtitles do come up. And it says something about, I don't belong in this world. I feel separated from others. And was that in the movie that you saw, or was that just something that fucking YouTube was just bugging out on?
I think that was something YouTube was bugging out on. But, Tim, you have, like, a storied history with YouTube subtitles. So
I think it's because of me. Because aren't they killing the subtitles? You want to auto-generated subtitles sooner?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, just what's that episode of Tales from the Crypt with Old Digger?
Old Digger, yeah.
Yep.
Good Old Digger.
Yeah, and I think so they say his name many, many times in an episode, and they never corrected the misspelling of it.
No, they didn't, sir. And I remember I had to go back and check it, because I'm like, I don't know if Tim's okay.
Yes, you know what, Eddie? That's right, because that brings me back, because that was the very first grind bin related thing that I ever did. I already done Daniel's show, but that was the first time I was going to be on the grind bin, which is, you know, the Holy Grail. And I was going to be on the mini bin. And I'm watching with the subtitles. And I'm like, whoa,
wait a minute.
What the fuck did I just see? And then I'm like, oh, wait, I got to rewind it.
We got the Crypt Keeper dropping N-bombs. What the hell is going on here?
So I rewound it. And literally like 3 or 4 times, I call my wife into the room. I'm like, I am seeing what I'm seeing, right?
I'm going
to record this on my phone just in case. After I talk about this, for some reason, they change it or take it down. And that would be Tim. Canceled day one.
Yeah, no, brilliant move, by the way. If somebody tweets some shit that's fucked up, instead of just, like, quote tweeting it, always take a screenshot.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, people can delete or edit shit. So, yeah, good move, man. So, no, it didn't say anything about that in the subtitles for me.
But it comes back later on, right?
It does.
So that's why when I saw it later on, I was like, wait, what the fuck?
That is weird, because I think when she's talking to the doctor, it comes up. But I might be
Yeah, well,
mistaken.
anybody who wants to take the chance, take the time, just go on YouTube, get up to this part where she crashes the car, and it's, I think, right after she crashes the car and she's looking around outside, that's where it comes up, where it's going to
Oh,
be
and
the
hey,
subtitles.
this movie's public domain, so I can freely tell you that I have a copy of it on the blood bank, too. So there you go.
Yes, all right, yeah. I should, that's where I should have watched it.
It's the very good quality copy on
I
that
what
one.
I ended up switching over to Tubi, and Tubi had a really good copy, and the sound was really great on it too.
God bless Tubi, man. We should get them as a fucking sponsor.
Oh man, you know what? We'll give them half price on the ads.
I'll
Just
just promote their shit for
$200 an
free.
ad.
Like, as many good movies as I've watched on that service without paying a penny. Come on. Fucking great.
I might regret saying this later on, and I might get a ton of hate tweets, but I would not mind paying that company $5 a fucking month for their
I could see
movies.
it. I could see it, especially if you cut out some of the commercials.
Even with the commercials, because the commercials aren't that bad, but
No, they're
just the
not.
collection of fucking shit that you find on Tubi, you're just not going to find anywhere. And there's another one I have on my TV only. I think it's called Midnight Pulp.
Oh, yes, I've seen that one.
They got
That's a
some
very
fucking
good.
crazy ass shit on that.
Yeah, they got some doozies, man. So yeah, she stops, gasses up, and asks the gas
See,
man
we can
about.
do commercials, people.
Yeah, there you go. There's see we there we did some free commercials, okay? We're not even getting paid.
Next ones we're sending you a bill for them.
We'll send Tubi and Midnight Pulp a bill, and then they'll send us a response that says, "Who the fuck are you?"
Cease and desist.
Oh God. So yeah, she asked the gas man. She's like, "Hey, what's that old weird abandoned building that I've been staring at as I've been driving this whole time?" And he says, "Oh, that." Now I'm trying to recall exactly the history of it.
I have it written down.
Okay, so he
It's the
says,
old bathhouse,
"Okay, it was a
which let's
bathhouse."
get
So,
back to that for a second in a
well,
minute.
put a pin in that.
Then it was a dance hall, and then it was a carnival. A bathhouse.
In Utah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know where you want to go to party is a
Well,
Utah
no, I'm thinking,
bathhouse.
well, first of all, it's Utah, okay? So, you know, they don't even like have a Coca-Cola machine in the bathhouse. So that's the kind of
That's
place that
true.
you're talking about, Eddie. But back then, like, let's say, guys, because this is like 1962, the movie came out. So figure with the history, it's already been three different things. That's kind of, the bathhouse is probably like, what, maybe the 30s?
Yeah, it would
Maybe
have
the
had to have been a
40s?
while.
So what the fuck was a bathhouse back then? I mean, literally, was it just people going there?
It was an old wash tub that somebody had outside that occasionally the horses would drink from.
Is it something like to like the equivalent of what I would know is like a Korean sauna where you go there and maybe you got like a hot springs type thing or
Yeah, or is it like a Russian bathhouse where they beat you with those weird sticks
Although,
and
like those
yell at?
branches and leaves, yeah.
What the fuck are the? And this is Utah, so this is the Mormons, right?
Yeah, right? So, I mean,
The fuck is I
how do
they're
you get
supposed
beaten
to?
with branches if you have your magic underwear on?
Well, yeah, they have to have the magic on. But then again, though, because this was like in the 30s, so they were still cool with polygamy back then, right?
Yes, and back then when they saw this movie, it wasn't in black and white, it was only in white.
That's very true. Yeah, they were
This
into
podcast is
polygamy
not
more.
brought to you by the Church of Latter-day Saints.
Man, they were into polygamy. They should have called it more women, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh,
More
no, but you see,
women.
no, look, they did this smart thing. They did the Frank Lutz thing. They turned that shit around. More men. Right? I think we talk about this in the Discord. Nobody wants to pay. Who cares about if some rich motherfucker dies and has to pay an estate tax? But wait, me? Poor guy, I have to pay a death tax? Hell no. Fuck that shit. I don't want that. It's all how you phrase it. So instead of more men, more women, went more men.
It's all PR spin, my friend.
Yep.
So it's a bathhouse that went out of business and became a dance hall, that went out of business and became a carnival.
All things that you would not associate with fucking Utah, the
Yeah.
land of Mormonism, right?
Yeah, bathing, dancing, and gallivanting and traipsing around and playing carnival games. I don't.
Dance hall. Maybe this is where they shot. They shoot horses, don't they, with Jane Fonda?
Oh, God. Maybe, yeah. I don't know, though, because
I
I
saw
just
that
have.
movie way, way, way too young.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. So I just have, like, I can't think of a creepier setting than an abandoned carnival bathhouse. Like, that's
It's
not
got
good.
everything, right?
It really does, man. So she says, ah, that's cool. Hey, here's an address for a rooming house, which, okay. She says, I want to go to the rooming house. And the dude's like, oh, yeah, that's just over, and then just points oh,
It's
down
actually it's a
there.
pretty cool transition, right?
Yeah. Because then we cut over to her going to the rooming house. And she meets an old lady that's too nice.
Well, she's very nice, and I really think, well, I think she has that thing where it's like cleanliness is next to godliness, right? Because she's
Yeah.
sooner or later she's really pushing bathtubs and taking
Oh my
baths.
God. So yeah, okay. So she says, "Hey, here's the house. Everything, is cool. There's only you and one other person in here. He's probably never gonna come up, though. Don't worry about that. And by the way, there's a bathtub. I wanted to point that out to you. And feel free to take as many baths as you
Yeah, it's
want
a
to."
private bath, so you can take as many baths as you want. I'll never bother you or
Yep.
bust your chops about taking baths. It's something to that
Okay.
effect. But here's something I just thought of right now.
Yeah.
Utah, 1966, rooming house, and men and women are living there and on the same floor and right across from each other? Hell
Yeah.
no.
No. No, this does not pass the sniff test, sir. You're absolutely correct.
Yeah, because you literally had it where it was either men's boarding houses, rooming houses, whatever the fuck you wanted to call it, whatever the difference might be. I think probably rooming house, you had some money. Boarding house, you maybe had a little bit less money, just depending on like hotel, motel.
Well,
But there was
yeah.
no way that they were going to let men and women on the same floor
No.
next to each other because all those whole things were about you couldn't have any guests after like 8 o'clock at night and shit like that.
Yeah. No, you see, I think the old lady here has got some sort of a peeping scam situation going
Oh
on.
shit, she wants to see her in the bathtub, and then she's like, maybe the guy's gonna come over, and he's like,
Yeah.
hey, I don't have a bathtub in my room.
She's charging punks a nickel a man to peek through the keyhole at her.
That's where she's making her money on the back end.
She's making money off of this broad. Yeah, I'll keep the sandwiches coming. Don't worry, sweetheart. Why don't you go take another bath? Oh, you know what? I'll bet she put the bathhouse out of business.
Oh, that's right, because she's giving away fucking free baths all the
Yeah.
time.
How can you compete with free? Oh God, yeah, I have exactly that same note, Tim. Is it just like, why is she pointing out all the free bath situation? Whatever.
Wait,
So,
maybe, Eddie, she has a. But that. Remember that story you told us about that girl? She has that same condition where
oh,
maybe
good
like as
Lord,
soon as she walked
Misty,
in, the
yeah.
lady's like, hey, maybe you want to take a bath and take a
Oh,
bath
God.
every like couple of hours or something until the smell goes away.
You know what? Maybe it's because Mary was just in that fucking gross, muddy swamp fucking lake for 3 hours. And she's
Doing God knows
like,
what.
yeah, and we don't, I mean, we never saw her take a bath after that. So,
Wait, was that girl's name really Misty?
the
Oh
funky
my
broad
God.
from Washington's, her name was Misty.
I thought you. I, every time I heard that, I was a little bit drunk, so I thought it just made like your eyes misty.
Very true, yeah. God damn, that was. I hope she found love. And Mary's about to find some love too, because,
Oh,
oh
creep.
God.
That's what I have written
Yeah.
down. I don't know what his name is really, except for creep. I think they said his
Yeah.
name was Lindell.
Yeah.
And as
His
soon as I heard this, I
name.
was like, oh shit, Mike Lindell's father.
No, his name is Johnny Linden,
Okay.
like the people that made that Second Life game, the Lindens. So that adds
Thinking
up.
about Barry, but okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, she. Well, She goes to unpack her shit. And, yeah, we get the peeping situation coming up with, well, first it's the weird, white-haired guy, that she saw when she was driving.
Yeah, in the window reflection, peeping in the
window. Yeah. And she looks out, but nope, there's not actually anybody out the window. So off to church.
She's very blasé about stuff that, I mean, if I saw stuff like that, I don't believe in ghosts or anything like that, but if I thought I saw some old fucking ghoul's fucking face looking in my window,
yeah,
I would probably question it for longer than she does, right?
Yeah, yeah. So she does go out shopping a little later on. I would have maybe stopped by the gun store. Oh, fucking ghost or whatever you are. Huh?
We'll 1962? Holy Christ, they're giving them away.
Yeah, back then? Oh, yeah. If you open up a bank account, they give you a free gun.
Today they do. So just imagine back then. There's just like baskets of guns.
Yeah, that's true. That's like I was saying, the diner across the street from where we lived in Florida had a concealed carry permit classes at a diner.
You got to make every square inch of the restaurant pay something, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it was one of those great diners where everything was like cow print with the stupid dots on everything. They made a really good fried catfish, though.
Well, it's also good for target practice, right?
You know what? I never verified this. Maybe people were just shooting the holes in the wall.
That's right. It was a stark white wall, and everybody's just fucking target shooting with their shotguns.
Could have been, yeah. It's Florida. Anything could fucking happen. So, yeah, she's in there looking around at the organ. And the priest says, I'm going to show you my organ. More organ talk. And he says, hey, you know, she sits down to play for a minute.
And he's like, hey. He also says that it's made in her hometown.
Yeah, yeah.
So she grew up in a town that makes organs, and she decided to become a professional organ player.
Yeah, that's weird. What did they make in your hometown, Tim?
I used to live in Astoria, close to Steinway Street, named after the Steinway Piano Company.
Hey! So
it's got that.
But you never got into playing piano.
No, I wish I would have known that if where you grow up, if they make musician instruments, you could grow up to be that kind of musician. I could have been playing this piano on Carnegie Hall.
Or you could have. Carnegie Hall. Yeah, or Carnegie Deli. which they're closed down now, aren't they?
Yeah, well, I think they even closed down before Corona.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, because I heard that a lot of like how they were able to operate was because of how cheap brisket was. But after the barbecue trend picked up in Texas, the price of brisket went up.
Well, I ordered from them like one time. And wasn't that great. Maybe it was better in the actual place but instead of having it delivered. But
what are you going to do?
Yeah.
So, yeah. She, the priest guy's like, hey, I'd like to, you know, introduce you to a bunch of people. You know, let you meet the congregation, meet the other people. She's like, nah, I don't want to do that. I just came here to play the organ.
This is my kind of lady. I like this. This is my kind of style. Yeah. I'd be like, you know, fuck this shit. I don't need to come to a party. It's a small town. In like 3 fucking weeks, I'm going to know everybody anyway, right? Got here. Let me fucking rest and relax a little bit.
Yeah, look, I'm just trying to figure out how to do my job. I'm not trying to go to have a party with some weird priest. Like, what are we talking about here?
Like, you already want me to touch your organ. You're watching me play with your organ. What else do you want?
Is this when she's playing the organ barefoot, by the way?
Yes, and I'm wondering, here's something. First of all, I really did not know that people who played the organ in churches got paid. I thought that that was just something you just like volunteered to do that.
Okay. So,
but I guess the learning to play the fucking organ isn't like playing the guitar and you're just like, hey, I could do that off the cuff.
I have one example of knowing about a person who was paid to play the organ in a church. And that was the guy that wrote the Satanic Bible, Anton LaVey. I had that book when I was an idiot. What's that?
I had that book when I was an idiot.
Yeah. It's stupid. It's like a dumb philosophy book or whatever.
It's every teenage boy is going to buy that book.
That and the Anarchist Cookbook. You know.
Can you buy that anymore? Because I remember the copy that I got, I had to buy it off the street. Like
Yeah.
drugs.
Yeah. Well, they tell you how to make drugs like fucking banana peels.
Yeah, it didn't work.
Nah. So you tried to fuck it and then instead you got sick.
I got an infection. There's a great documentary about the guy who wrote that book, who is completely oblivious to what he unleashed on the whole fucking world by writing that book. And at the end of the documentary, when it dawns on him, it's worth the whole fucking watch of the documentary.
Interesting. I'll have to look for that. So yeah, no, Anton LaVey, he wrote a story about it. He used to play organ for the church on Sunday, and they would pay him to do that. And the only other place he could find, ironically enough, to get work to play organ was at a carnival that was the night before. So he said it was funny because he would see people that Saturday night out boozing and whoring and, you know, having a good time, and then you'd see the same people Sunday morning in the church.
Makes perfect sense, yeah.
It does, man. It really does.
Well, it
So,
gives
yeah.
you an out, right? You just have to go to confession, whatever you did, it's okay.
Yeah, that's real handy. That's fucking convenient. I like back when it used to be just indulgences, so you didn't even have to you didn't even have to say you were sorry. The church was just like, I don't know, like $50, I guess.
Now they're like, hey, you know what? $50 and 10 Hail Marys.
All right, how about I give you $100 and no Hail Mary? This is bartering. That'd be good, man. So yeah, she's like you said, hats off to her. She's just there to do the job, man. And so she plays a little bit, and we see somebody coming in to the church, and uh-oh, it's the creepy gray hair guy again.
Yep.
But no, it turns out it's actually the priest. We get a lot of these kind of scares where she's mistaking regular people for the creepy people.
Yeah, where she's like kind of like slipping in and out of hallucinating, which what she's seeing, who she's seeing, what's going on around her.
Yeah, a lot of mind playing tricks on her. So the priest says, "Hey, I noticed you were still in here playing the organ. I was gonna drive out by the lake. Do you want to go drive out by the lake?"
And all my years of being an altar boy have taught me
Um.
no. No, you do
Oh.
not want to drive out by the lake with the priest.
No.
But she's
Well, I
okay
mean.
because she's not a boy and she's like over 21.
Right, yeah, she's safe. So she's like, "Yeah, I mean, are we gonna drive by the old weird building I've been staring at?" And he's like, "Yeah, of course, let's go."
Oh, you
So,
mean the bathhouse? I mean
I
dance
mean
hall?
the dance hall, yeah. I mean, wait, I probably shouldn't be doing that
Oh
either.
yeah, wait, the carnival. Oh wait, no, I can't go
Oh
there
shit,
because
can't go
that's
there
got a
either.
little bit of
Fuck.
everything.
The abandoned carnival.
Yeah, that's
Yeah,
right.
yeah. We drove them out of town. So yeah, they drive out to the weird old building, and she gets out and she goes over to the fence that's been erected around it, and it's you can tell people have been busting into this thing for years, man.
You know, I was just gonna say, this is where all the teenagers are hanging out, right?
Yeah. I'm surprised it's not vandalized more, you know?
But wait, hold on, we're forgetting something. It's Utah.
Oh, that's true.
So I don't know how Utah teenagers are. Do Mormons have like that Rumspringa thing?
I was just gonna ask, is there a Mormon version of
No.
Rumspringa? And
That's too many syllables. You can't say that.
are you kidding me? If they let those kids get out of their sight for 5 minutes, that shit's over with, man.
You know what? All respect to Rumspringer, because is there any other religion that does that? Where they're like, all right, look, yeah, you've lived with us for 18 years, go out into the real world, see what it's like, and then if you like that, stay out there. Although they're ill-equipped to stay in the real world,
Yeah,
right? So of course they're just
that's the
going to want to go
problem.
back, but you're still giving them that slight window of opportunity that I don't know if any other religion. All those years in Catholic school, they never said, you know what, Tim? Why don't you go hang out with some of your Hebrew friends and see what they have to say about what's going on
Yeah.
with religion? And then if you like it, come back to us.
Hey, Tim, why don't you get a couple of Hebrew friends, go up to Atlantic City, buy an eight ball, get a couple of whores, and then come back and tell us what you think.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Oh, Christ. That's what I think. What have I been missing?
Wait a minute. Got something else figured out here. So, yeah, no, she wants to go into the old building, though. She's like, well, hey, come on, man, let's go check it out. And he's like, I don't know. If somebody, like, saw a priest breaking into a building, like...
Yeah, that's right. He's like, I don't know if it would look very nice if a man of the cloth broke the law.
Yeah, it would be unseemly.
I've already been transferred 7 times for breaking and entering.
Yeah, a little different kind of an entering.
Back in the good old days when it was just breaking and entering.
Yeah, back in the good old days. So she's like, all right, well, I'm just going to, like, come back here later by myself anyway. So whatever, dude. Let's go to your weird lake or whatever the fuck we were supposed to be doing up here.
Yeah, you know what? Really, again, I really like her because she's just not taking shit from anybody. She's like, all right, you know what? Fuck it. You don't want to take it? I'm just going to come back here by myself.
Yeah, she's got a mindset, whether you like it or not, sure.
Yeah. Somebody makes a comment about that, too, which, and again, in 1962... they probably could have fucking put her in a mental institution for being like this. Having mind of her own, and like a priest is telling her what to do. And she's like, well, fuck you. I'm just going to do it the way I want to.
Yeah, yeah. No, hats off to her. So they go back to the rental. And I have a note. The fucking lady tells her to take a bath again.
Yes, again, that's right. Take as many as you want. God. No fuss. You'll never get any fuss from me. Just let me know before you're going to take the bath.
Yeah, just tell me when you're going to take the bath. And she's like, oh, that's cool. Also,
you gotta change the color of the tickets so nobody uses the same ticket twice from yesterday.
Yeah. It's also just like, by the way, I'm hungry. Like, well, I don't have fucking food for you. I guess I'll make you a sandwich. I don't know. So, whatever. She goes upstairs and takes a bath. Well, Tim.
Yep.
This is where we get to meet the real hero of the movie.
Our hero, yes.
Good old Lyndon. Mr. Johnny Lyndon. And he goes over, starts knocking on her door.
He knocks quiet, too, the first time, right?
Nice and quiet.
Yeah.
And then he hears the bath running. He's like, oh, I'll wait until that stops, and I'll knock real fucking loud after that. It could seem urgent.
Mm-hmm.
And I have, like, the second that she gets into the bathtub, he knocks. I'm like, God damn it. That fucking sucks. So she did not get to take a bath. She just got fucking, okay, I guess I'll
just
towel
getting
off.
Situated, yep.
What's that?
She's just getting situated in the bathtub, getting all nice and comfortable, and then he's knocking on the fucking door.
Yeah. So he knocks on the door. She goes up, oh, it's Mrs. Thomas over here with my sandwich, clearly. So
yeah, because doesn't she say something like Mrs. Thomas? And he doesn't say anything. And then she opens the door, and she has a little chain thing on it, and that's what stops it from opening up all the way.
Wait, because this guy, like, fucking shoves the door open.
Like, I thought they were going to cut away with showing him put his foot in the fucking door, like an old-fashioned salesman or something like that.
God. He practically does, because she unhooks the chain and he's in the room, like, immediately.
Yeah, he worms, I have written down, he worms his way past her into the
worms.
Fucking room.
Perfect term for it, dude, because this fucking dude greases his way into the fucking door. And she's like, hey, dude, can I go get dressed, you son of a bitch? Like, what are you doing? He's like,
again,
yeah.
Eddie, 1962, this is pretty risque for a fucking movie, right? She's in fucking bath towel.
So she backs up. She's like, all right, look, just hang on out here. Wait out in the fucking hall, you creep. I'm going to go put some clothes on. And he does this slick move, Tim. This is a good one.
Yeah. Look, as much as I'm calling him a creep, I might be out creeping myself here, but I don't know if I want to do the same thing.
So he goes back to the side of the door with the hinge. which is still partly open.
Yep.
And he starts, you know, checking out the goods.
He's perusing, you know? Yep.
And he's like, ah, okay, okay. I get it now. I see where we're going. Time to ask her out to dinner.
Like, well, there's a weird thing that they do where you see her in the towel, right? And this is what he's peeping. He sees her in the towel, and she puts her...
like a gown, something.
I almost want to say like a house coat almost, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's not like really a gown. It's not a bathrobe, but it's like something like that women would wear back in that time.
Right.
And after she puts that on herself, she lets the towel loose and she like shimmies a little bit and the towel comes down.
Mm-hmm.
And it cuts back to him and he's like, oh. And I'm like, well, dude, no matter what, she was naked underneath the towel as much as she's naked now underneath the fucking bathrobe slash house coat or fucking gown.
This guy's got some weird proclivities. I think he wants to get that towel.
He said, I don't have a bathroom in my fucking house, but I'll take that towel.
Yeah, I'm gonna go sniff the towel or some shit. I don't know. He's a creepy guy. So he's like, hey, I haven't eaten yet. Have you eaten yet? She's like, nah. He's like, that's cool. Let's go get some dinner then. Come on. She's like, wait, no. What? Hold on. I don't know you.
I already ordered a sandwich from downstairs. What the fuck?
Yeah, I ordered a sandwich from Mrs. Thomas, who made a point of saying that this was not a boarding house, so they don't have food, but she's got some sandwich leftovers.
Do you think she's going to put it on some of her famous English muffins?
Could be, yeah. Yeah, the ones with all the nooks and crannies.
Yeah, all right. Thank you, Eddie. You caught on.
Yeah. I like a good English muffin, man. It's been a minute.
Can't go wrong with them.
No. So, yeah.
Bottom part's the best part, though. Hate that top part. I like the bottom part better than the top part.
Oh, yeah. Top part gets too dry.
Yep.
Yeah. Too thin gets too dry. Nah. Be more substantial. She's like, look, you got to get the fuck out of here, dude. Like, I don't know you. Get the fuck out. And then smartly, she shuts this dude down, kicks his ass out of the fucking room. It's like, see ya. I got food coming up. Bye. Gotta go.
A lot harder getting him out of the room than he got into that room, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That's very true. So she gets dressed and goes wandering around the house for a minute. And then she looks down the stairway and she sees the fucking creepy guy, not Mr. Linden.
It's funny, yeah, because all the times I have written down my note is she sees the dude. The dude is in the hallway. The dude is in the church.
Yeah.
And every time I have him, the creep, the creep, the creep.
Yeah. The creepy gray-haired guy. I don't think they ever give him a name or anything. He's just like a zombie kind of looking dude. But, yeah. She sees him. She's like, ah, shit, I got to get in my... No, I really got to lock myself in this fucking room. What between Mr. fucking Grabby Hands there and this guy? Shit.
Mm-hmm. She might want to find a different place to stay.
Yeah, that would probably be a good idea. So she backs in there. She locks the door. And, well, just a moment later, someone goes to open the door. And the chain gets all, you know, stuck in place and... Doesn't say who it is, though.
And actually, legit creepy scene.
Yeah. Yeah. So finally, we find out that it's Mrs. Thomas with the sandwich and the coffee.
And the muffins.
And the muffins. And she says, hey, did you see the dude? What the hell was the guy doing in the hallway? Did you walk up here? Did you see him? She's like, I didn't see any guy. The only guy that's in here is Mr. Linden. What are you talking about? And he's not creepy at all. He's very normal.
And, I'm not watching him take baths.
Yeah, it's for real. That, you know what? Mr. Linden's definitely paying to see her take those baths. Now, God damn it. And that means Mrs. Thomas is in on it.
Of course she's in on it. That's why she's pushing in the baths.
Yeah.
It increases her profits.
So, yeah, Mrs. Thomas insists, nah, there's no one else in here. But then she starts getting fucking nervous. She's like, look, you could hide a man in every corner of one of these big old houses, for all I know. And I'm like, shit, what the hell kind of business is she running here, man?
Mm-hmm. Is she like the H.H. Holmes of Utah?
Oh, dude, she could be. Hey, wait a minute. Maybe that's why all these businesses are fucking running under. This broad's killing off all the travelers.
Yeah, that's right.
She could be
Like,
like
before you go
the.
to the bathhouse, come
Yeah.
stay here. Look, you're going to spend all day at the bathhouse, but you need to sleep somewhere, right? I'll
Yeah,
give you
that's
half price
true.
if you bring back your bathhouse ticket.
Yeah. And all of a sudden, people just start going missing.
Yeah.
She's flush with sandwiches and coffee to offer everybody. It's, I don't know, man.
Then all those fucking depression area people going there for fucking dance marathons to try to win $20. Who's gonna miss them? I think we're on to something.
Not with Mrs. Thomas in town and her fucking murder house.
It's a fucking acid bath. That's how she gets rid of the evidence.
Yeah. Oh God, or she's like the old lady at the inn and in the Mouth of Madness. Fucking monster lady killed her husband. So yeah, we have a little discussion about how maybe Mary should skip the coffee tonight because clearly she might be a little I don't know, unnerved. Maybe a little caffeine might keep her awake. And Mary says, "No, coffee never keeps me awake."
Doesn't it keep everybody awake? Because back then there was no fucking decaf in 1962,
Yeah.
right?
Well, that and then the note I have is cut to Mary laying awake in bed with bug eyes. So I think the coffee might have kept her awake, and she's staring all out the window at the fucking building some more, and then we cut to the next morning, and who knocks on her door, Tim?
Oh, Creepy McCreep with something behind his back. Which, are you going to let this guy into your room, number
No.
one? And number two, he's obviously hiding something behind his back. For all she knows, it could be a fucking hammer that he's going to
Yeah.
fucking hit her in the head with.
Yeah. We don't know what this guy's fucking business is. And
It's
so.
no good business. Whatever it is, it's rat soup eating fucking business.
Yeah. This guy needs to fucking leave. But no, she invites him in, of course. And he's all dressed up. He brings her coffee. He says, I'm
Wait,
sorry
is he
about.
dressed up? He's dressed.
Was
Because
dressed.
later on he makes a comment about how he makes his own coffee so he doesn't have to get dressed and go out of the room.
Right.
And he's
Yeah,
like,
that's
well, I
true.
guess I had to get dressed now.
Yeah. So he brings her some coffee and he's apologizing. Look, about last night, I was
It was
just,
just jokes. I was just joking.
yeah. This fucking move, the it was just a joke move, no.
Yeah. Oh, no, he doesn't even do that. He's gaslighting her right off the back. He's like, I
Oh
think
my
you
God.
misunderstood me.
You're crazy. It wasn't me being creepy. You're out of your fucking mind. By the
When I
way,
snuck into your room when you're in a bath towel, and then I
yeah.
peeped on you through the fucking crack of the door, you got that all wrong, honey.
By the way, you want some booze?
He's like, right, damn, Irish fucking coffee.
Yeah.
He says the classic thing. I'm not an alcoholic. I just like to start the day off in a good mood. And then
Yeah.
she comes back, she goes, oh, you must be a clown by lunchtime.
Yeah. It's 'cause he does in the movie does he dumps a little booze in his. He's drinking it for a second. He offers her some. No, she's like, "I don't look, man. I got to go to work, you know?" And he's like, "Oh, okay, cool." Then he dumps more booze in his drink.
Well, yeah, well, this is also where he finds out what she does. Because
Yes.
she says, I have to go to work. And he says, what do you do? And she's like, I play the organ for the church. And automatically,
Oh.
he's like, whoa, shit, I didn't know you were a church lady. And she's like, no, it's just a business.
Yeah.
Basically, she says that she plays for pay.
Yep. And don't tell this guy where you work. Like,
Well, Ed, it's a small town, right? Of course,
that's
he's going to
true.
find out where she works.
That's
So,
true.
being a woman, all right, we're guys, we've never had to do this, but she kind of has to placate him a little bit so he doesn't
Yeah.
get pissed off. And if he's going to find out something sooner or later, maybe she's just playing it right with, it's like, instead of me, like, telling him, like, fuck you, and getting him pissed off the bat, he's going to know where I work, so just tell him.
That's true. That's true. So he's like, "Oh, cool. Let's go get some food or something then." Again, this guy with asking her out to go get a bite to eat. She's like, "Nah, I can't do that. I gotta go shopping." So Cut to her shopping, and she gets this dress. She goes into this dressing room, and there's this fucking bell that will not stop
ding,
ringing.
Ding, 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 ding. What the fuck is that bell?
I don't know. At first, I thought it was like an elevator, or maybe it was like the door.
You know, yeah. Wait, hold on. It does kind of sound like the elevators, like when the doors are opening. Department store, because it's not a cash register. It's not the fucking PA system.
No. But it sounds like an elevator, but it's going off every 3 seconds. So I don't know. So we cut to her in the dressing room, and this dressing room, by the way, is giant. But whatever. I guess this is a small town where everybody's rich or something. I don't. Well,
I think what it is, it's a small town, and this is like. Unfortunately, in Utah, this might be like the only place for the women to like get together and at least relax for 10 minutes before they got to go back to the fucking asshole husbands.
Yeah, that's true, man.
There's no dance hall anymore. There's no carnival.
Yeah, that's true. Or maybe you send all of your wives into the dressing room at the same time. So she's in there, and all of a sudden. We get a weird, like, wobble screen gas effect. And this creepy organ music starts popping off again. It's like, oh, shit. Well, something went wrong in that dressing room. I don't know. Maybe they got a busted pipe or something.
Yeah, because everything except for the organ music is quiet. You can't hear any sounds.
Yep. Can't hear any of the atmospheric sound at all.
David Lynch, you hack.
Yeah, and she goes to open up the door, and it's kind of like stuck, so it doesn't really open at first, but then it does. So,
right. Well, it's a sliding door, and she's trying to open it like a regular door.
Yeah. So she gets out, she brings the dress up to the saleswoman, she's like, hey, yeah, I want this, go ahead and deliver it, or whatever. The saleswoman just kind of like walks past her, like, ah, shit. She goes over to old lady and tells the old lady, she's like, hey, that sales lady's rude. What the hell's her problem? The old lady ignores her, too.
Yep.
Nobody's interacting with her, and she can't hear anything. We know she can't hear anything because she leaves the building, and there's a dude with a jackhammer, like, just breaking apart the sidewalk.
Yep.
And not a sound. So she's like, what the fuck? Well, I guess I'll go to the park for a minute. So she heads over to the park. She waits under a tree. And we hear a bird chirping.
Okay. Let's put a pin on that one, too, because I think that comes back later on also, right?
Yes.
All right. And so I have no idea what that's supposed to be representing, but...
Okay. So we hear the bird chirping, and then all of a sudden, the sound comes back to the world. And she's like, oh, that was weird. I think I had like a stroke or something. I don't know. So what do you do in the 60s when you think your like brain's breaking? You just go get a drink of water from the fountain.
First of all, I'm just glad that this is in Utah and it's 1962 and that water fountain did not have a sign over it.
Yeah, that's true. That very well could have had a sign over it. So she stoops down, she gets herself a nice little drink out of the fountain, and she goes to stand up, and uh-oh, it's the creepy guy, maybe, we don't see his face.
No, it's the dude, okay? The creepy guy lives across the hall. Oh, the really creepy guy in this movie lives across the hall from him, man.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, we can't call him the creepy guy anymore. We gotta call him the less creepy guy, I guess.
We just call him the pasty face dude.
Yeah, pasty face. So, oh, shit, it's pasty face, but nah, it's not. It's just some guy. And she stumbles back from some guy. And, like, handily enough, bumps into another dude. Guy's like, hey, are you okay? What the hell's wrong with you?
Yeah, he stops her, too, right?
Grabs her. Hey, stop, young lady. You're falling into hysterics, and you're crazy. And he keeps shaking her and telling her she's, like, needs to calm down, which... I don't think that works.
In 1962, it worked because she's a woman and she's upset. That's true. So it must be hysterics, right? Yeah. And of course, she has to calm down. I'm just glad he didn't smack her.
Well, I was just gonna say that's probably the next step is you backhand her.
Well, we're gonna find out he's not that kind of a doctor.
Okay, so then he says, "It's a good thing you ran into me. I'm a doctor, right?" So here, I'm gonna take you someplace that's not where we're at right now, and I'm like, "Oh shit!"
Yeah, luckily for you, my office is right across the street.
Sure,
you,
it is.
Sir, from the water fountain, can go along about your business. I am taking this hysterical woman away from prying eyes.
Mm-hmm. Let's get you someplace a little more private.
Yep.
That's good.
Too bad he didn't have a van.
Yeah, that's true. Then he would have been like a mobile doctor. Okay. He's in the room, and she's telling him everything that's happening. She's like, "Look, I had all these problems. It's fucking all of a sudden I couldn't hear anything. It was weird. And then all of a sudden I could. I don't know." And this doctor starts grilling her. He's like, "Well, what? I don't know. I think maybe you had like an emotional shock from your crash. By the way, you were telling me some dude's following you. I think you imagined him. Does he remind you of somebody, like your husband or your boyfriend or your dad?"
Well, I think you're skipping an important part here, Eddie.
Okay.
Because while she's sitting there in the office talking to him, the camera cuts to them in the office, and she's talking to him.
Yes.
And he has his back turned to her in the chair.
Yes.
Okay? And as she kind of like wraps it up a little bit, and before he goes in that whole speech about, well, you've had a traumatic experience, you know, you 3 days ago you were in a car accident, you were the only one who survived, blah, 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 blah. He turns around from the chair where you now can see his face, mm-hmm. and he says, "Oh, I'm sorry, I was just taking some notes."
Yes, yeah. He says, "Sorry, I was writing all that down. I didn't mean to turn my back to you."
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then is this where we find out that he's... Well, first of all, here's my first tip-off that there's something wrong. Well, the second tip-off.
Okay.
Pinky ring.
This guy had a pinky? I didn't notice.
Why do you have me on the show?
Okay. No, I know
why. He has a pinky ring on his fucking finger. Well, guess which finger he has it on. And it is a big-ass square. It almost looks like a fucking class ring on his fucking pinky. And I'm like, whoa. No psychiatrist is going to wear a pinky ring, right?
Well, yeah. Speaking of no psychiatrist... So she tells him all this shit, like you said, Tim, and he's like, "I don't know. I think
I'm taking
maybe
notes, everything."
I think maybe you're crazy. I don't know, though. I'm not a psychiatrist.
I'm a chiropractor. Right?
I'm like, wait a minute. Why the fuck are you even talking to this guy?
Oh, wait a second. Is he a doctor like the first lady, Dr. Jill Biden? Where that's not a real doctor, right?
Yeah, it could be like Dr. Dre. Maybe it's like an honorific, you know?
There you go, right?
Cosby, they gave him a honorary doctorate. Maybe it's like
it's
that.
It's a small town. I bet you that this guy is a doctor the same way that guy who hangs out at the bar is a colonel.
Yeah. Or her neighbor in the boarding house is a not rapist.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the closest boarding house that's the furthest away from schools.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he does say he's not an alcoholic, so I mean,
which means you are an alcoholic.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm like, why on earth is she talking to him? So she's like, "Okay, cool. I figured it out then on my own. If it's my imagination, right, and the pavilion, the weird building is involved, clearly what I need to do is go out alone to an abandoned amusement park that used to be a bathhouse because I already have like a tenuous grasp on reality as it is, so fuck it."
But again, here it is. She's standing up to a male figure of authority in 1962.
Yes. No,
and
it's very
doing
true.
The exact opposite of what they are telling her to do.
Yeah.
To the point
where
this guy
true.
Is like, "I'm a doctor. Come to my office. Spill your fucking guts. Tell me all your deepest, darkest secrets. Oh, by the way, I'm not actually a psychiatrist. I mean, if you have a problem with your foot, if you have a fucking ingrown toenail, I can take care of that. If you have some wax buildup in your ear, I could take care of that.
So my coworker's daughter is becoming a doctor, right? And I guess she just did all of the med school stuff. And at the end of it, they have this test that basically places you for what field of medicine you're going to get into,
Okay.
you know? And some of them are much more profitable than others,
Of
obviously. So
course,
like,
yes.
So like anesthesiologist,
Brain
dermatologist.
surgeon, dermatologist probably at the bottom, right?
The dermatologists make a shitload of money, apparently.
Really?
So he's telling me all these things. He's like, oh, you know, maybe she'll try to be this, maybe she'll try to do that. And I told him, I said, you know what? I was thinking about it. If I was going to be any kind of a doctor, you go with foot doctor. Because worst case scenario, we just got to cut the fucking foot off. You
Well,
know what I mean?
no. You got those fucking ingrown toenails, which I had, and actually I have a video of them taking my toenails off.
I get those. I
I
get
think we should
those
put
too.
that on
Those
the
suck.
Patreon if anybody wants to pay extra money for that. But that's real
Jesus.
horror. But you can get some. No, dude, there's got to be a show on TLC, I bet, or Discovery Channel about people with fucked up feet, right?
No, I'm just
So.
saying, like, say you're a brain surgeon, right?
Yeah.
You fuck that up. Oh, man.
But you're a brain surgeon, all right? Nobody knows about the brain. Hey, shit happens. You know, I'm kind of like an explorer, right? Everybody knows everything that you can learn about the fucking foot already. There's no mystery in your feet.
I'm just
In your
saying, and
brain, you'd be like, look, I did everything I was supposed to do, but hey, dude's fucking brain. What am I
yeah,
supposed to
but
do about it, huh?
okay. So, like, if you have to go tell the family some bad news, right? So, I'm sorry, Mr.
We had to
Yobo.
cut off
We,
his brain.
I'm sorry,
Sorry.
Mr. Yobo. We were working on your wife, but now she thinks she's a chicken because we did something fucked up with her brain. Versus, I'm sorry, Mr. Yobo. She just lost a foot. See? I'm telling you, foot doctor, man, they got it made.
True. Well, I guess that's why dermatologists have it made, because what's the worst that you have to say? We had to take the mole off?
We gave you the wrong cream. It's the other one.
That's right.
Like that's the most of their fucking job. So she heads out to the abandoned amusement park, and dude, so many red flags when she gets here. Okay. So first she's like walking around, and there's these big like bumpers or some shit in the background, and they just start moving.
No, first she goes through the spin tunnel that's not spinning, which I
That's a
went
good
through one
scene.
of them. Have you ever done one of those? Dude, that's really fucking hard to walk in.
I
So
mean,
that's not,
hers,
you gotta
at least
break
hers
my.
wasn't spinning though.
Yeah, that's true. Then she does see the fucking barrels that I think it's probably something where like she steps on a certain area in the floor and it just does that just because it's like, haha, funny. And then we got the big ass slide.
Now here's the problem.
Go ahead. Yes, go ahead. Yes, I
Big
have this
ass
written down
slide,
too.
and all of a sudden, like the mattress behind the porno theater comes fucking tumbling down the slide.
Yes. And did I remember being on those slides when I was a kid? They never had a mattress. It was like a fucking like a felt thing that you sat on. So people were fucking on that mattress. That's how it got there, right?
They
And
had to have been.
then what's bringing that down? Is there really a ghost in this fucking place? Is there somebody there? Or is that just her imagination?
No, I think it's Mr. Linden. I think he's up there getting rid of the evidence from the last fucking broad that lived
Oh,
across the way
that's
from
right. He's like, nobody ever goes here anymore. This is a great place to get rid of the fucking bodies. And then now here's this fucking bitch.
Better be Caesar down there, and he's dropping hints. So then I guess she gets to the bathhouse that's the dance hall now at the very back of it.
Well, you
She.
do get sweaty dancing, so taking a bath might be a nice option.
Yeah, I also wonder if this used to be like a hangar too, because it's massive.
The way it's set up, it's very weird. It almost looks like like you could do like a fucking indoor fucking horse race.
It's giant, right? I'm like, what kind of a bathhouse was this, man? Like, holy, because it's all open floor. I mean, it looks like a big ass, like a
I think
round
what it
tent
was, Eddie, I
room
think there
kind
was a pond there and they just built a roof over it and they
of.
just called it the bathhouse and that's it. That's why it's so fucking big.
Yeah. Well, and clearly, because she goes to the back and she like finds a coin or something on the guard rail and just tosses it off into the water. And what do we see, Tim?
We see our creepy, pasty-faced dude.
Yeah, Pasty Face is laying underwater. And, like she, I guess, didn't see him or something. I don't know. Anyhow, back to the rental. And back to Mr. Linden asking her out for dinner again.
He just don't give up.
He doesn't, man. Shooters shoot, you know what they say.
Well, one thing he's lucky is the word stalker hasn't been invented yet, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we haven't taught him that fucking word yet, man. Stalker, that's just one of those bad words that people like judges have. I mean.
If I could go back in time, the two things I would do would be kill baby Hitler. You know what? Just be safe. Just kill his mother,
No, I
right?
was.
Because maybe the next one could be even worse. Who knows?
Everybody wants to kill baby Hitler. Why don't you take him and give him a good house? Just raise him upright.
Why take any chances, right?
Because you do that to him. And
Well,
then you
no,
just.
hold on, hold on. All right. The Boys from Brazil. Have you seen the movie?
No.
Wow. With Gregory Peck?
I haven't seen it.
Oh,
What's
Eddie.
up?
All right. That's a great fucking movie. But all right, I'm going to spoil it for you.
Okay.
Gregory Peck plays, I think, Mengele.
Okay.
And what they've done is they've taken like Hitler's DNA and they've impregnated like a bunch of people over the a bunch of women over the whole world. So they could have Hitler's baby and get the Third Reich going, I guess it would be the Fourth Reich.
Okay.
And the end of the movie is he goes to the one kid who the DNA, the upbringing, everything worked perfectly fine.
Yeah.
Okay, because it wasn't just, it wasn't just his DNA. One of the kids grew up and he was like, he was a regular kid, but this kid grew up and he was going to be the next fucking Hitler. And he grew up in basically a pretty good home.
Okay.
So, I mean, he wasn't poor, he wasn't rich, but why take that chance? And the other thing I would do, I would go back into like 1940 and introduce the word stalker.
Yeah. Definitely, because this fucking dude. Hey, are you hungry? No, I ate something on the way here. Okay,
Well,
well.
was it a whole lunch? Was it half a sandwich? Aren't you hungry again?
No, you didn't. I mean, oh, you did, huh? Oh, okay.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I saw you. I forgot.
She's like, yeah, then I gotta go to work. And he's like, okay, cool. How about after work, we go dancing? She's like, I don't want to dance. Like, what do you talk?
The
Where?
dance hall closed down, motherfucker. What kind of bullshit is that?
Yeah. So he's like, what are you like afraid of men? Because you seem like you're cold.
Oh, see, here we go. Here we go. This is the fucking gaslighting thing, right?
Yep. More of that. He says, by the way.
1962, you must be a lesbian because you don't want to go out with me.
Yeah, and then I love this fucking line. He says, also, maybe I could walk you home from work, you know, because it's probably better to walk home from work not alone at 9 p.m. And I'm like, this dude, this is the, it's a real nice business. It'd be a shame if something
Yep,
happened.
that's right.
Yeah,
Either
this
I'm gonna walk
fucking
you
guy.
home, or when you're walking home, I'm gonna fucking jump you.
Yeah, exactly. Look, you can have me or have me with a ski mask. What do you want? That's basically the choice he's giving her here. So she's like, all right, I'll be out at 9 p.m., I guess. So I'm like, wait, she's going to work playing organ at the church at 9 p.m.
Well, when I used to be an altar boy, there used to
Uh-oh.
be every not all the time, but there used to be the 8 p.m. mass.
Okay.
And that was the one that none of us wanted to serve because what they would do is every Wednesday they would call us out because that was one of the great things about being an altar boy. Well, hold on. Let me rephrase that. One of the perks, oh, wait, hold on. That's not exactly the right word. One of the things that they suckered you in to be an altar boy was that you would sometimes get out of classes early, or you wouldn't even be able to go to class because you were serving at 12 o'clock mass, right? So if I'm doing the 12 o'clock mass when everybody else in the school is having their lunch, I get to do the mass, finish at 12:30 or 1 o'clock if it was a big high mass, and then I would get my half an hour lunch break and then go back to class. So I am cutting my school day by some time,
Wow,
which
what a
is a great
treat.
thing. Yeah. And every year they would all take us to an amusement park and we would get like $20 worth of tickets. That was a big thing with it.
That's cool. The amusement parks, rather. But you say you're cutting your class time, but you're just doing mass now too. Like that's to me the equivalent of class time.
No, Eddie. You obviously were never Catholic because after a
No.
while it just become all I had to do was just sit there. I could think about whatever Spider-Man cartoon I wanted or whatever comic book I was going to pick up at the end of the day, and then just like, oh wait, he got to this part, now I have to stand up. Oh wait, he said this, now I have to go to this part and stand there. Oh, now I stood
Okay.
there. Okay, now I have to go sit down. That was it.
So it's a lot like having a conversation when you're married.
No comment. Since my wife has now started listening to the shows a little bit more, no comment. I have no idea what you're talking about. I love to hear what happened to her during the
Oh
day.
yeah, it's a treat. So she's at night church, but there's no one there. And this is when she's playing the music and she just starts thinking about like hey,
I
what
think this
about
is where she's
the uh
barefoot.
was that?
I think this is where she's barefoot.
Yeah, this is for the Tarantino got inspired by this scene.
Yeah, there you go. That's right.
So she's playing the piano like barefoot. Because you know they have the little pedals on the bottom that I guess they, I don't know, like they make it go super fast or something. I don't know.
Dude,
One's
I
the
don't know. The
clutch.
fucking organ looks like it's goddamn hard to play, right?
Yeah, it does. It really
I mean, you're
does.
using fucking everything. With the piano, you don't use all both of your feet, right? You use one foot for those three pedals.
Yeah. Now this organ looks pretty intense, man.
Thank you. That's what she said.
No, Tim. Well, she's certainly enraptured by the organ because she goes into this weird fucking trance. And then she's night falls, and I guess she's like imagining a bunch of water zombies coming up.
Yep,
And then they're
dude and
all.
some lady come out of the water.
Yep. And they're all dancing at the old carnival dance hall.
In
And
high
there's a.
speed, like Benny Hill.
Yeah. They speed it up. It looks like the film. So it looks fucking creepy as hell. And then the weird guy, she sees the pasty face guy dancing, and then he turns to her, he walks up to her, and he goes to grab her, but no, it's not him, it's the priest, and she's still playing the piano, and he grabs her
Another kind of
hands.
creepy guy.
What's that?
The different kind of creepy guy, the priest.
Yeah. Yeah, creepy guy number fucking three in this. He grabs her hands and he's like, "What the hell are you doing? What you're playing is sacrilegious music." And
Profane, sacrilege, he
yeah.
says. What the fuck could she be playing on a church organ that's profane and sacrilege?
Well, it's not the 13th century anymore, so it's not the tritones. That was considered bad by the church and outlawed to be performed. So I don't know. I don't know though. This is Utah, so maybe they hadn't caught up
I
to
mean,
that.
Iron Butterfly isn't around yet, right? 1962?
Yeah, that's true. She's playing Inagata DaVita out there.
Fucking Bart Simpson switching those fucking books.
That was so good. The poor old lady had a fucking heart attack practically.
Yeah.
Oh man.
Oh man, when The Simpsons used to be good, it was so
Yeah,
good.
it was like the first 12 seasons or so, right around there.
10 or 11, I'll give it.
Yeah, right around
Once
that
they started
point.
getting like every other week was like a special fucking celebrity guest host, that's when it went downhill.
Yep. The minute you have to have all those fuck, I mean, because you had Aerosmith in the Flaming Moe's episode, and that was good, right? The
Yeah,
Flaming
but then
Moe's
you got
episode was okay.
U2, you had fucking countless fucking people on, where it's just like, come
Yeah.
on.
When it's every week now, went to shit. He tells her, you know, I'm going to demand that you resign from doing this.
My
Like,
conscience says
yeah.
that I must ask you to resign. I'm like, dude, just fucking fire her. Give her the fucking unemployment at least for 6 weeks.
No, they're not going to do that. Come on. So she's like, all right, cool. Just kind of picks up her shit and starts zombie walking away. And he's all like, but you know, if you need the church and you need me, I'm gonna be right here. Don't, I'm
Yeah,
not.
no, he's like, yo, bitch, I don't like the music that you're playing. Get the fuck out. And she doesn't beg him. She's like, oh, she's not nothing like, oh, I'm sorry, I need this job. And she's like, okay, you know what? Fuck you. I'm a professional organ player. There's you, and there's tons of carnivals who need me. And then he's like, oh, and then she's walking. I don't want you to think that the church or I are abandoning you.
Right,
We're
yeah.
just kicking you out because you played music.
Yeah, we're not abandoning you. We're demanding that you resign so we don't have to pay your unemployment. Oh, okay, cool. Well, thanks, dude. So she leaves. And who's waiting downstairs, Tim?
Well, she did tell him to meet her at 9 o'clock, right? But
True.
he does say at one point, I was waiting for you for a long time.
Yeah,
And she
yeah.
was in that iron butterfly moment, and that's like what, 32 minutes? So
Yeah.
now it's like 9:30, 9:35, and he still waited. So yeah, he's
Yeah.
a fool and a creep.
Yeah. So he puts out his cigarette, says, all right, well, let's get out of here, Toots. Let's go get into my car. And I'm like, oh God, don't do that. Do not get in, don't go anywhere with this man. But it turns out they just go to Mel's Diner, where they serve alcohol, apparently. Now, first of all, it's Utah, so whatever beer they're serving here has to be under 3.5% alcohol by volume.
And well, I also have another question: is are jukeboxes
Yeah.
legal in Utah?
Well, Tim, they are, but when you dance, you can't move from side to side. You can only move up and down.
That's right. Just jump up and well, no, wait,
No jumping.
move. No, all right, well, then how do you move up and down?
You have to bend it, the knees slightly.
So then I could see her buttocks,
That's true. I guess you just
and
have to
then she's kind
nod
of
to the
around my
music.
crotch area unless I'm crouching down at the same time. So, you know what? Let's just make dancing illegal all out. That's it.
Dancing is forbidden.
That's it. It worked for that one town, right?
Yeah, for a minute, yeah. Oh my God. Mr. Linden, he's
Here we go.
definitely not
His
an
true
alcoholic.
colors are showing because he's had a few too many now.
Yeah, it seems as though he's been overserved, as they like to call it. And he's, you know, he's hitting on her. He's trying to lay down some game. It's not working too well. She's like, "What the? I'm sorry. Okay, what? Hold on. You need to calm down, dude." And he's like, "Look, you got to like loosen up, broad." That's basically his approach.
He says, what's wrong with you? You don't like drinks. You don't like dance. You don't want any man to hold you close.
Yeah. And just about
And
then.
it works, right?
Yeah. But no, just about then's when his buddy stumbles up to
Oh, fucking sweaty McSweaty, huh?
Yeah, fucking fucko comes up to him. He's like, "Hey, what's going on here, buddy?"
I guarantee
And
you that guy's name was Vinko.
that was Vinko. Johnny and Vinko. Oh, God damn. So he's like, "Hey, that broad you're talking to, she looks better than the usual like hogs you bring in
He
here."
says, yeah, the pigs. I think he says
Pigs.
pigs or piglets, he says.
Yeah, same.
Something pork related, something that you never want to refer to a woman as.
Yeah. Not like your usual sows you bring in here. He's like, "Ah, I'm gonna go take a crack at her." The guy's like, "Don't go take a crack at her. I'm taking a crack at her." And I'm like,
Right.
"Wow, this is real cool. These
This is
guys are
big
great."
dick energy, right, Eddie? Let's say if the two of us are friends and we're not married, and
Okay.
I'm in a bar and I'm talking to some chick, and you walk up to, you're playing pinball, all right? And I pass you on the way to getting some more drinks, and you're like, "Oh shit, hey, look at her, she's pretty decent looking. I'm gonna go over there, I'm gonna try to fuck her," and
Yeah.
then I'm like, "Whoa, no, Eddie, hold on, I'm trying to fuck her."
Yeah.
What does he say? He says, why don't we try to warm her up together?
Oh, God damn, dude. Going
How does
family
that
style
work?
on her.
Yeah, how does that fucking work?
I mean, you could. Okay, if what he meant was, I'll play wingman to try to
No,
help you
I don't
out.
think so. I don't think he's going over there. He's trying to cluck cuck his fucking friend right there. And then he's going to be like, oh, you know what? No, you know what? Let me be your wingman. That's not the way it works.
Nah. Yeah. Nah, they're going to go family style on her. It's not good. So he walks back from the jukebox after he puts on the song that she says she loves because he's being fucking snarky and shitty with her. This guy is a piece of shit, dude. And he's like, oh, yeah, I was just talking to my buddy over there. He said there's some broad he's trying to hook me up with. It's like 10 times hotter than you. So I'm probably, I probably should do that, right?
Whoa, whoa, no, no. Slow your roll, Romeo. Hold on. Yeah. I want to spend the night with you. I want to be next to you.
Yeah. Yeah, because the woman is having a fucking nervous breakdown. And you're, what the fuck, the gaslighting this dude has been doing. Like you're saying, like, she's basically being held hostage at this point.
Yeah, because he's like, don't you appreciate what I'm buying you? I'm buying you, that beer costs fucking good money. There's nothing wrong with it. Fucking drink it. Drink it fast. I'm already on my seventh beer. You're still fucking nursing that shit. What the hell's going on?
Look, fucker, it's not the beer. It's the company, okay? Get the signal.
Yeah. And but again, what's incredible about this movie is the time that it was done was, you know what? Yes. If I was a man and I took you out and I spent a certain amount on you, I am expecting something.
Yeah. No, it's true. And, well, she kind of loosens up to him a little bit. And's like, yeah, I want to be with you tonight. Let's go on and get out of here then.
Yeah, why did she take this turn?
Yeah.
This is the one part of the movie that didn't really make sense to me. Why she does this.
I think she's conflicted internally because she was scared that this fucking dude is stalking her ass. And she's like, look.
Pasty face creep. And she doesn't want to be alone. So being with this creep is better than being alone by herself.
Right. She's like, look, I could not necessarily have to put out with this asshole.
And maybe... you know what? Yes, Andy, because that's why when he said to her before, it's better to walk home with me at 9 o'clock at night than to walk home by yourself. Mm-hmm. That's why she agrees to it, because she doesn't want, she figures if there's somebody with her, she's not going to see creepy pasty face.
Better the devil you know than the devil you don't.
God damn. I'm sorry, women. Those are the choices that you have to fucking make in life. Yeah. Creepy guy lives across the hall, a pasty face creepy guy who's haunting me.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know if this dude's method, but I know in the next scene, he's stumbling up the stairs. And he pulls it off, man, let me tell you.
I don't know, because the way I have it written down too, I was like, whoa, been there. I've done that on a fucking staircase, right? And tried to recover. It doesn't really work.
Just let that handrail guide you up.
Yep. He really sells it, all right? No matter what, this might be the best acting that he does. If it's not an accident, it's the best acting he does in the whole movie.
What's coming up, I think, might be his best acting in the movie.
Which, by the way, I just thought about it. This guy looks like Roscoe from... Hill Street Blues.
Roscoe from Hill Street. I haven't seen Hill Street Blues in for fucking ever.
They were the street cops, the black and white cops.
Oh, okay. I think I know who you're talking about. I'll have to look up.
Yeah, I think he's a director now.
Yeah, yeah. Huh. Okay. You have to take a look at that one. But, yeah, he stumbles up the stairs, invites himself into her fucking room, and he's like, look, you can't get too far away from me. I'm right across the fucking hallway.
Right. Now, I have called this guy a creep the whole fucking show through. But for real, what she says to him there in the bar is like, I want to be with you tonight. I want to be next to you tonight.
Yes.
Now, of course, she can say no at any point, and when she does, that's it. But she says that to him, so if some woman says that to me, I'm assuming that we're going into her room.
Yeah.
Not my room, because my room doesn't have the bathtub. Her room has the bathtub.
Yeah. There's an expectation at this point. She has set the
Yes, but as soon as she shuts that shit down, that's it. It's done. Yeah. But yeah, he at that point he should be thinking, yeah, we're going into her room, because when he climbs up the stairs, she's like, "Oh, quiet! You're gonna wake up the old lady." And he's like, eh, "Don't worry about it. We can make as much noise as we want. She's in the back of the house," and she's not like, "What?"
Yeah, I don't worry. Yeah, I could kill you. She'd never even hear it.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Chainsaw, nothing's going to wake that old lady up.
No, no, she's got her hearing aid out. It's no problem. So so she does let him into the room, but she's not really fucking feeling it. She looks like she's having a fucking nervous breakdown. She goes to the mirror. She looks in the mirror, and who's coming up behind her?
Pasty face.
So she freaks the fuck out and starts screaming, right? Which, and to old Johnny's credit, the old lady doesn't come in when she starts screaming. So, yeah, he's
well,
right.
I think they have an arrangement worked out, right?
Oh, God, yeah. She's just going to bring some extra towels.
No, see, Johnny boy caught Granny peeping in on the women taking the baths. Mm-hmm. And he's like, "I'll keep your secret if you keep my secret."
Yeah. So she starts screaming, and then she turns around, and he's not there, of course. It's Mr. Linden, who's not even close to her.
He hasn't been it's not like she's looking at Linden and thinking that that's the old man. She's looking in the mirror, and she sees him.
Yeah, yeah. So Mr. Linden's back a ways, and she just starts like, "Look, some fucking guy's after me. You got to help me." And this dude sobers up immediately.
So would I.
Yep. He's like,
"So
oh,
would
shit. I. You know what? Never mind. I got to go. You're fucking crazy."
Yes. If you've ever been on a date and some woman, if you're not even next to her, and she just starts screaming and yelling,
yep,
get out.
And
best thing that you can do for her and you is just get the fuck out of there, right?
So Johnny pieces out of the movie because he's gone.
That's right. We never see him again, right?
No, he's fucking done, dude. He's out.
He like, packed his bags. Oh, fuck.
He goes down to that fucking old little hick town that she lived in. He's like, "I'm going to go start trying to dredge the car up, too," or something, man.
I'm going to go work at the organ factory.
Yeah, head to her hometown. Fuck that, man. So he leaves. And what does she do? Well, she starts going into classic zombie survival mode of pushing furniture against all of the doors and windows. And we cut to the next morning when the doctor, quote unquote, shows up.
Oh, man. And you know what's even crazier is we're going to find out in a couple minutes that nobody called this doctor.
No, he just was like, Miss Thompson's like, "Hey, I'm glad you just happened by."
Happened by, and he's like, "Oh, I was thinking about her all day since she left my office yesterday, and that woman had the gall and the gumption to not listen to what I said, so she must be crazy."
And because he's a psychiatrist, he's not a psychiatrist.
No, he's possibly a foot doctor and probably a chiropractor, I'm betting, right?
Maybe. With that pinky ring, he's something.
Oh, shit. Maybe he's like into crystals and he's that kind of a doctor.
Dr. Feelgood.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they were prescribing broads those fucking speed pills back in the day. So maybe he's, the town dealer.
Well, not only that, but you know who invented vibrators, right?
No, it wasn't me. I know that.
All right. Well, who knows if this is 100% true, but I read it and it sounds like it could be true. A doctor supposedly invented it because he was getting tired of having to manually stimulate women to cure them of their hysteria.
Right, right, because they used to believe that their wombs were going like crazy animals in them or some shit.
Well, no, basically what was going on is that women would go to a doctor and they would complain about not being satisfied or being depressed or something like that. and the solution was to masturbate them,
Ugh.
because having an orgasm wasn't something that their husbands were exactly knowing about or caring about.
Jesus.
And doctor said, hey, you know what? I made enough money. I'm going to retire. Let me invent this machine.
Yeah, yeah. He invented the washing machine. They could lean up against it.
Well, actually, it's funny that you said that, Eddie, because I believe that in the Sears catalog, and somebody could check this and see if I'm right or wrong, the second thing that was sold in the Sears catalog that was electric was a vibrator, and the first thing might have been either a vacuum cleaner or a washing machine.
Jesus.
But the second thing was a vibrator.
Nice. Nice. So yeah, maybe this guy's just peddling vibrators all over town, man. Who knows? He was gonna he had his suitcase with him.
Dr. Feelgood.
Yeah. Yeah. So now he talks to Mrs. Thompson. Mrs. Thompson's like, yeah, she just says she's gonna fucking leave, I guess. I don't know. She's gonna get out of the city. And Mrs. Thompson agrees. She's like, yeah, I hope so. Hope she gets the fuck out of it, because I can't deal with this. She was up moving shit around all night. It's crazy. So Mary packs up her shit. Zombie walks down the stairs, walks right past Mrs. Thompson. Mrs. Thompson's
again,
like, hey.
Just not taking any shit, not making any excuses, not asking for any, like, a second chance. Just, all right, fuck you.
Yeah, and Mrs. Thompson's like, where are you going? It's like, bitch, bye.
She needs a gossip, right?
Yeah, yeah, that's true. She's like, well, how? And then I love, she's like, well, how can I refund you for the week? If you leave like this.
Lady, you know you're keeping that fucking money no matter what.
Don't worry. Don't you worry. Mary is just trying to get the fuck away from all the creeps in this goddamn town. You included.
Peeping creep.
Yeah. So she pops into her car, starts driving off, but uh-oh. It's got a rattle. And I know this because the subtitle says, rattle and rattling continues. So
what kind of sound does it make?
What's that?
Sorry, joke.
So she drives the car over to the shop. And the guy's like, all right, go ahead and drive it up on the lift, you know, like you do. And he's like, you know, you can go ahead and get on out of there. She's like, no, I'm going to just stay in the car while we work on it. I don't know. I mean, how common was this going on?
What, staying in the car?
Yeah. Just hanging out.
Again, I don't have a car. I never had a car, but I would imagine it depends on like what needs to be done.
Well, he said it sounded like the transmission, so I don't know. Maybe he thought it just needed some transmission fluid or something. Who knows? But
yeah, look, I could see sitting in the car going through the car wash because that's kind of fun. Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah.
And maybe, you know, if you're young, you can get quickie in, but. Yeah. Sitting out there by yourself. Well, again, you know what it is? Here it is, Eddie. She's being separated from the rest of the people. She's by herself and separated from everybody else.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, I get why she doesn't want to, but like, goddamn, dude. Let's just really test this hydraulic lift, shall we? Let's just throw another bra. Although she couldn't go over like $110. So
yeah, and come on, back then those fucking cars used to weigh 10 fucking tons.
That's true. That's very true. So yeah, he jacks her up.
If anything, I'd be more worried about her fucking hitting the fucking gas or fucking putting in reverse and running off the fucking ramp while underneath the car.
Which he basically does, though. So yeah. So she takes a ride on the lift, and she's like, well, I'm gonna just take a little nap while I'm up here, I guess. Nods out. But then somebody comes into the garage and lowers the hydraulic lift for her. And then I guess they're like trying
no,
to get in.
No, wait, hold on. I have written down my note. I don't think it's the lift. He turns a valve.
Well, right, but you hear that, and then I think that's what lowers the car.
But she falls out of the car, doesn't she?
That's true. Yeah, she opens the door and stumbles out.
You know what? No, wait, hold on. You might be right, Eddie, because we see the door opening and she falls out, but we don't see her falling. So she could be just hitting the ground from 6 feet or 6 inches.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. So she runs away because, you know, somebody's fucking in there trying to kill her or something. I don't know. And she runs over to try to catch the next bus out of town. leaves their car behind. I get it, man. I get it. But when she gets into the bus depot, we get that weird film effect again. Yep. And all the sound goes away. It's
Wayne's World, right?
Yeah. The film kind of waves, and then we do an extreme close-up. So she runs over to one of the people working there. She's like, hey, I need to get the next bus out of town. And they can't hear her again. Well, shit. She can't hear anything. She tries to talk to a couple of people. But then all of a sudden, she hears a loudspeaker announce, the eastbound bus is loading on gate 9.
And didn't she come from the east?
Yes.
Okay.
So she's like, oh, okay. Since the only thing I can hear is this loudspeaker talking about a bus and nobody's interacting. I should listen to it. What's that?
I should listen to it, right? That's the only thing I can hear.
Plus, nobody's going to stop me if I just try to get onto the bus without a ticket because they can't even fucking hear me. So, whatever. You know? So she runs over to the bus, gets on real quick, looks into the back of the bus, and it's just filled to the rim with fucking pasty-faced ghoul people.
And again, another creepy scene.
Yep, because they all just kind of laugh. Like, hey, well, we got you now. He starts shutting the bus door, but nope. She finagles her way out, a lot like the creepy guy, out of the bus, and runs off, like you do. She tries to go to a cop to get some help. He can't hear her. She tries to go hail a cab, but it just drives off. So where does she head, Tim?
Well, now she's in an alleyway, and she almost gets hit by a fucking van, right?
Yeah, she does.
And again, another scene where she was really fucking almost hit by that goddamn van. It was like 2 inches between her and the van at one point.
That was pretty close there, man. That was a hell of a stunt.
But then after that, she goes back to like a little park area, like a treed area, right?
Yeah, back to the park, back under the tree.
And now we hear some birds chirping, and after the birds chirp, that's when the sound comes back. And what is your take on that, Eddie? Because I can't figure out what that's supposed to mean.
Yeah, I think it ties into the ending. The twist is, maybe. I might be wrong, though.
But birds there?
Maybe. Well, I don't know. Because was it daytime? I don't know. We'll get to it.
It was daytime, but I mean, where this movie ends and what the twist is and everything like that, why would birds chirping be the thing that brings her back?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a good point. So, she goes back to the doctor. And she's like, look, man, I had to come to you because it was the only place I could fucking think of where there's a person who's not creepy.
Just somebody pretending to be a fucking psychiatrist. And then after I spill my guts, by the way, HIPAA doesn't apply to me.
Yeah, no kidding. Because I'm Dr. Fucking Feelgood, like you said.
That's right. And I will talk to your landlord about everything going on with you medically.
Yeah, what the fuck, by the way? Well, this was before HIPAA, so sure. I mean, the family doctor probably also was the milkman and delivered fucking chickens or some shit, too. Who knows?
And again, it's a small town, so no matter what, everybody's going to find out.
That's true. So, she's trying to tell him what's going on, but he's got his chair turned to her again. And this time, the big reveal, he turns the chair and, uh-oh, it's Pasty Face.
Yep.
But then we go with the, and I just have Nightmare on Elm Street, you hack. Uh-oh, it was all a dream.
See, this is how we're going to tell how old I am versus you. I have written down, Dallas, you hack.
It was all a dream.
Taking a shower. Isn't that fucking Bobby?
Yeah. Okay. So, she wakes up in the car. It was all a dream. And she backs out of the mechanic shop because apparently they lowered the lift already. Maybe they finished the repair. I don't know. Because we don't hear the car making the noise anymore. And she drives off, and the mechanic's like, what the fuck? But he's not going to.
Hey, she didn't pay.
Yeah.
Hey. Come back here, lady.
Hey. Yeah, she did not pay. And where does she go, Tim? Well.
Where are you going to go? Carnival.
Go back home. No, she's going to go back to the abandoned carnival. Because she's, well, at this point, she probably just wants to figure out what the fuck's going on, right?
Well, I guess that's a logical place to go to, right? Because that's where she's been drawn to since the fucking beginning of the movie.
Yeah, yeah. It calls to her, Tim. She drives up there. She wiggles her way back through the fence and gets in there. And I just have that she's not carnival personnel, so she shouldn't be in there. But, you know.
She doesn't have a pass.
No, no. And she walks her ass back to the dance hall. And here we see all those fun, sunken, dead people raising up. And they're having a fun dance party. Only this time they're not going super fast. They're just kind of having a nice little dance. And well, we see...
At the end of the night, you got to slow down, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This one's for the couples, we can tell, because Pasty Face Guy, well, he's got a date. Tim?
Looking familiar, too, right?
Yeah, yeah. He found himself another fetching blonde young lady. Holy shit, it's dead-ass Mary dancing with him.
Dun, dun, dun.
A twist. She fucking screams. And then they all look at her like, dude, what are you screaming for? That's rude. It's just a real buzz.
You're fucking up a vibe, man. Come on. Get my groove on.
Look, I'm trying to fuck this dead broad, okay? Let's... Oh, sorry. That was last week's movie. she screams and starts running off. Then they all just chase her, of course, which is what you do. And we have a nice little kind of Scooby-Doo run through all the different areas of the abandoned.
Yeah, I like how when they have the camera like it's stationary and you just have all the ghouls or the dead people running past the camera and some of them doing like jazz hands at the camera and everything like that.
Yeah, some of them are really, really having a good time with it, for sure. It's like, okay, I get it. You got some of the local theater troupe to come out here and do this.
My time to shine!
Yeah. Yeah, I'm that extra who's going to be dead set in the center of the frame. You're going to make sure you see my face.
Hey, that guy from Crank, he learned how to do it, right?
Yeah, red shirt guy, that's true. Crank 1 and Crank 2 bonus episodes on the Patreon, patreon.com/bloodybits. Worth a listen.
Hey, you got that down.
Yeah. So they run out of the dance hall. They're chasing her. They're chasing her, like, underneath of the dance hall area.
Is it because it look kind of looks like underneath the boardwalk? Which
it does.
All right, Eddie, let me ask you a question. Is there water in this fucking place?
No.
Are they next to an ocean? Are they next to a lake?
No. So they are...
Go ahead.
From what I understand, this is supposed to be a dried out lake.
Okay, like because lake, yeah, at one point you say, one of the things at the carnival, it says salt water baths.
Yes.
So yeah. I'm assuming it's... Well, wait, Salt Lake City.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so the lake is dried up, I guess. And she goes running. Like you said, it does look like it's like a under a boardwalk.
I've seen enough Baywatch to know what underneath the boardwalk looks like, so mm-hmm. Trust me.
But nobody's having some fun under the boardwalk here. No, they're just going to kill her ass, apparently, because she runs... out into the middle of the dry lake bed. She falls down, and, well, the angry mob, they get to her.
Yep.
We have that classic scene of them, you know, over top of the still camera, all closing in on it, and they finally caught us.
Again, a legit creepy scene.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Especially for its time, too, man. Think about it, 62, this...
Well, see, that's always a problem, especially, like... Again, because this is literally the first time I've seen this movie, and I've heard of this movie my entire life. I've known about this movie my entire life. Well, maybe not my entire life, but like being aware of movies and seeing it for the first time, It's all stuff now that I've seen filtered down about a billion and a half of the fucking times in movies and TV shows. So the thing where she is in the auto repair shop and it's a dream, which back then might have been like maybe only the 10th time it's been done in a fucking movie versus now where it's been done a million fucking times.
It really is. It's kind of like if you watch like the first Halloween and you haven't seen it at all, and you try to watch it now, you'd be like, man, there's all these slasher movie tropes in here. And it's
Oh man,
like,
I saw that in the fucking movie theaters, and that fucking legit scared the fucking shit out of me, 'cause that was the
I'll
first time I
bet.
ever saw a fucking movie where you could once a killer, the bad guy was dead, he wasn't dead.
Then you're fucked because all the rules are out the fucking window.
And that
So
music, dun, dun, dun.
it's there's something to that, man. If where the tropes all came from, sometimes it's hard to go back and revisit it, you know.
Well, they're tropes for a reason, right? Because they work and it's something that everybody can identify with.
Yeah, exactly. It hits us on a kind of a fundamental level, right? So we cut to some time later, and we see the priest and a couple of cops, and they're all out
The
walking
doctor, the
around.
priest, and the cops are all out there, yes.
They're all looking around out by the carnival, and they see her car. They see her footprints in the sand running away from the carnival, and then her hands in the sand, and then nothing. And they're like, huh, that's weird.
That's kind of
Where's
spooky, right?
where'd she go to?
We don't see this every day, right? Wait, doctor, can you explain this? No. Priest? Yeah, oh yeah. Jesus carried her up to heaven.
Well, there was only one set of footprints, sir.
Then there were none, so Jesus started to fly with me.
Jesus turned on his fucking hover boots or whatever the hell he used to ascend. I don't know. So now we cut back to the bridge. The very beginning of the movie, Tim, that accident that we had an hour or so ago.
Yep, dredging for the car all this time. They finally found it.
Yeah, they
Pulling it out of
did.
the lake.
They're dragging it up, so they got it tied up to a fucking winch and yank it up out of the water. And what do you see, Tim?
You see the car, and then we see three people inside the car. The three women from the beginning of the movie. She's dead. She never got out.
She was dead the whole time, Tim.
Or did she go back to where she was supposed to be?
Or did she go back to where she was supposed to? Exactly. It's a mystery, Tim. So, I guess filming that scene where they were taking the car and her and them out of the water took a few hours, by the way. And she said that the water was fucking frigid.
Of course it is.
So.
Look, unless you're fucking filming in the fucking tropics or the Philippines, the water's
Yeah.
gonna be fucking cold.
Yeah. So it was whew. That had to be a fun one to try to film. Fuck
But
that noise.
why would they have to be in the car
I don't know.
when they were taking it out of the fucking lake, right?
I don't know. Their method, I
I
guess.
was
I
gonna say,
don't
that's really fucking method. Holy shit. Just take the car out, cut, put them in the car, and then turn the cameras back on, right?
You could easily do it with a cut, but I don't know. I guess you'd rather freeze the chicks. Who knows? So, Tim,
Yes.
what do you think? What do you think's the you think the this is this town never happened? She never really went there to play the organ. It was all just like a pre-Silent Hill, Silent Hill, maybe. That's kind of where I'm going.
Oh, one of those things where it's like, what is it? We were just talking about this, I think, with Candace on the grind bin. Incident at Owl Bridge or something? What's that fucking famous story? Where the guy's being hung?
It's not ringing a
And.
bell.
Fuck, shit.
If only
Some
we
guy
were in
named
a changing
Ambrose
room.
wrote it. Yeah, no, he's supposed to be being hung, and just as he gets hung, the rope snaps and he gets away. And he goes back home and he meets his family and all that stuff. And it turns out to be, it's just his hallucination right as his neck snaps.
Ah, shit.
And I'm thinking maybe that's kind of what this is. Because when you think about it, well, no, because the cops in the beginning of the fucking movie, the whole town saw her coming out of the water, right? The doctor talked to her. The priest talked to her. So unless she's completely hallucinating and making these whole people up, and then even after she's back where she's supposed to be dead, they're still going. I don't know. It's weird.
So Tim, I've got a fun story for you that I read a long time ago. This guy was talking about he was in high school, one of his buddies, just some jerk off, tackled him. Some football player, asshole friend of his, tackles him, he falls, he bangs his head on the ground, right?
Not playing football, just like walking down the street or
Yeah.
in school.
Yeah,
Okay.
he's walking down the street, crossing the street or whatever. He hits his head on concrete. Bang, fucks his head up real bad. So, next thing he knows, he wakes up in the hospital, right? Kind of cobwebbed in the dome piece, not doing great. And well, lucky for him, when he's in the hospital, he meets somebody, meets a woman. They get to chatting, and turns out they got a lot of things in common. And they kind of keep in touch after this. He goes through and graduates high school. He never like goes out and like beats the shit out of the friend, which is what I would have wanted to do. But whatever, forgive and forget. Now he ends up, goes to college, stays in touch with the woman, comes back. They end up getting married. They have a couple of kids. He's got a decent job. It's a little later on in his life. And he says, and then just one night he was sitting in his living room, and one of the lamps in his room, there was something fucked up with it. So he's looking at it, and it just didn't make sense to him. And he said, for some reason, the lamp, the perspective of it was completely wrong, right? Yeah. So he keeps staring at it and staring at it. And then eventually he fucking comes to. And he had just been unconscious this whole time after his buddy fucking tackled him and hit his head on the ground. So his brain released whatever dosage of DMT the brain releases to make you go into your happy space. And then fuck.
Your near-death experiences.
Yes. But he had lived effectively years of a life, getting to know these people, a job, having kids. It fucked him up. He ended up having to go to loss therapy for years.
That would be really fucked up. Holy shit, right?
So maybe it's this. Maybe that's kind of what's going on. This town, this job, the creep, the priest. Maybe it's all just a construct of her dying, kind of piecing shit together in her brain.
Damn.
Yeah. So I know
So
at
I'm
the
guessing we're going to recommend this movie.
Of course. Yeah, it's a wonderful movie. That, like I said, the soundtrack to it is amazing, and it's so brief. It's completely worth the watch. There are a couple of scenes where, like I said, with the long kind of tracking stuff with her driving and stuff, it.
Yeah, but if they didn't do that, could it be a movie at a fucking hour and 22 minutes? Because that's about like maybe 5 minutes, 6 minutes of the whole total movie,
Yeah.
right?
No, that's true. That's true. It's definitely worth, and like we said, it's public domain, so you can find it literally anywhere.
Anywhere, yeah, that's right. But
Yeah.
the best place to find it would be the
Best
blood
place.
bank.
Of course, the blood bank. You just gotta subscribe on patreon.com/bloodybits. So Tim, did you know they remade this?
Okay. When I was searching for this, I searched on Tubi, and there is another movie, I think it's like 1982, that's called Carnival of Souls.
Yes, so there's that one, and the one I'm more familiar with was in the 80s. I think it was like 89, and it was a Wes Craven Presents.
Oh,
Yeah, so it's just
yeah.
complete and utter trash.
Shit. It's like when John Carpenter says that the new Halloween is really great, and when James Cameron says the new Terminator revitalizes the whole series. It's just bullshit.
Yeah, exactly, man. Complete trash. So I would not recommend that, though.
No, look, if you're going to watch this movie, watch the original. Come on.
Yeah.
And there's also a colorized version, which I probably will not recommend, right? You want to see this in black and white.
Yeah. I think this works so well in black and white. I can't suggest. I don't know. I mean, there was a minute where we were colorizing everything. Just skip that. Don't even do it.
Look, maybe technology has caught up and maybe they can do it a little bit better, because I think there was a picture like the fucking Archduke of Ferdinand or something like that was on the internet the other day. It was colorized,
Yeah.
and that looked pretty legit. But back when TBS was fucking colorizing
Oh,
shit,
God,
no.
yeah, Turner. That guy was out of his fucking mind. Just ruining it. The saturation was bullshit. Like, it looked like crap.
Everything was blue. Everybody had brown hair, blue eyes. That was it.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, like, even with the technology, though, what was it? Human Centipede 2 was done in black and white and color. I prefer the black and white. It, I don't know, it's creepier. It just
That's a good
is.
question.
Yeah. So, Tim,
Yes.
this month we've been asking our guests a special question. What scares them? So we've asked our guests. One time we didn't have a guest, so we asked you, Tim.
That's right. Now we don't have a guest.
Now we don't, and I promised it at the end of it that I would go ahead and say, well, what scares me?
I am going to I'm going to mute my microphone because I'm going to fill up my volcano bag. So go
No,
ahead. Just
it's
please don't make it anything that involves a volcano bag.
okay. So it's I don't think it's going to take too long. I think it's a pretty simple one, really. And I think what scares me, honestly, is losing my sanity, being able just losing my mental faculties. That's why, kind of like I was talking about a little bit earlier with the person that got tackled and having that whole fucking weird fantasy life. The fact that I am nothing really but my perception of reality, and the fact that my brain can be fucked up, damaged, and I just lose memories, or I lose my ability to perceive or enjoy the things around me, or that they're all a lie. I think that is what scares me.
Well, I can definitely understand that. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Because exactly, once you don't have your memories
Yeah.
and you
Oh.
don't go ahead.
Yeah. Well, it's not just losing my memories. It's losing my memories, losing my ability to perceive things appropriately, just not being able to communicate any more effectively, going into dementia and things like that in
But
my age.
do people who have that happen to them, do they even know it? Like, please, Jesus
Yeah.
Christ, God, if that happens to me, don't
Yeah.
let me even fucking know it. Don't do a fucking Flowers for Algernon Charlie thing on
Oh,
me
God. Yeah.
where it's like I have fucking dementia, but I remember what it used to be like where I didn't.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's
Like, yeah,
true.
no,
I mean,
that's a legit thing. That's a
again, if I guess if reality is perception and then you don't perceive it as being a bad thing, then fuck it, right?
Well, yeah, because it's one of those things where it's like people who are insane, they never ask themselves whether or not they're insane.
Yeah,
It's
yeah.
that when you ask yourself whether or not, am I crazy, that you're supposedly, and who knows if this is true or not, but supposedly if you ask yourself whether or not you're crazy, you're not crazy. Because
Yeah.
crazy people or insane people wouldn't even ask that. They just assume that they're completely right.
Yeah. No, that's true. Yeah, I guess if you have that ability to assess it, then maybe you could treat it. But if you don't have the ability or even the thought to try to assess it, then you're just never going to.
Yeah, I'm sure Ted Bundy
Yeah.
never sat there awake at midnight going, "Am I doing the right thing?
Yeah.
What's wrong with me?" He was just like, "What the fuck is wrong with everybody else?"
Yeah. Hey, they all don't get me. You know what we should do, Tim? I think we should do an entire month of horror that is dealing with insanity.
If only there was a month that would like go along with that, right?
Yeah. So, I guess we'll go ahead and announce, Tim, that next month we have March Madness coming out. That's right.
Get your brackets ready, motherfuckers.
except it's not college basketball related. No, it's all films that have to do with psychological horror, be that Mad Men or questioning your own sanity. So stay tuned for that. We've got some pretty cool picks coming up.
I already
up
know
here.
Of one that's coming up. So
yeah, yeah. So next week's is probably going to be Demented, if I'm not mistaken. And we're going to be joined by those dastardly McCollum brothers.
Wow. So we're going to have a contest to see who can get more drunk on the show. Terry or Timmy.
yeah. It's a real
I'm
battle of the Titans.
Throwing down that gauntlet, motherfucker.
Real battle of the Titans, Tim. So I think we've, again... Just want
we
to say
are both
thanks.
Irish with that name and my and me being Irish. That's a tough feat to beat. Who can drink the most?
That's true. That's true, man. So again, man, I just want to thank all the Patreons for their suggestions and their continued support. Of course,
yeah. Thank you very much. You're keeping the lights on.
So shouts out to Steve. You're the one that suggested this one. So you'll be the guy that we talk about and feature on this one. And Tim, unless you have something else you want to promote or talk about.
Nope, I think that's pretty much about it.
All right. So, yeah, as always, you know, leave us a 5-star review. Otherwise, you're stealing from us. We're up to 33 5-star reviews now. I want to get that up to 50.
All right. Damn.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You know, I think what we need to do, we need to have some kind of like contest.
Yeah.
Because I remember what the Grind Bin did.
Oh.
Was they had a thing where it was like if you leave a 5-star review, you could get a movie pick.
Oh, interesting. Okay,
so
how about this?
We should do that, or maybe like whoever gives us like the 5-star review at the end of the month when we hit 50, we'll put everybody's name in a pool, and somebody will get my paper bag face.
Oh, that I went on. There we go. Yeah, you can get your own Tim Yobo paper bag face if you're the 50th 5-star reviewer.
No, not the 50th, because then everybody's just going to wait. Nobody's going to fucking post. Everybody's just going to wait until somebody gets to 49 and they're going to do it. But once we get to 50, we'll put all 50 people in a poll, a pool, and whoever
we'll put them all in
gets
the bag.
Picked. Yep. We'll that's right. Name. That's right. Whoever falls out of my mouth hole on the bag will get it.
Perfect contest, Tim. I love it, man. Yeah, so I think that's about it from us to cap off the week, Tim. And as always, this is how we end it.